There's a reason that we live so far from Hollywood. In the country, looking hard to find a home. But nothing perfect or considerable, we're so damn good. It's the story of your
morning, glory, America. Bonjour. Hi, Canada. Day two of Russia's invasion of Ukraine. No firefights yet in Ukraine as I open today's show. I hope you're doing well on this Wednesday. After the show, I have to make the dreaded trip to Florida, the free state of Florida. I love being in the free state of Florida. I don't like getting there, but Ed Morrissey will be in for me tomorrow and Friday. Let me run down what the president said yesterday. He imposed, of course, a wave of sanctions immediately criticized by the people who follow this most closely, like Tom Cotton and Mike Pompeo, is completely weak and inadequate. In fact, here's Tom Cotton on Fox with John Roberts yesterday responding to the sanctions cut number
one. Let's get some analysis from Republican Senator of Arkansas, Tom Cotton. Senator, you heard what the president had to say. You were critical of him earlier today for a tepid response. He's clearly upped it a bit. Two blocking sanctions on Russian banks, including their military bank. Is that enough?
No, John, unfortunately, it's not enough. I mean, at least it's a step in the right direction. I wouldn't even call it half measure, though. It's probably more like a quarter measure. Sanctions on a couple banks and some oligarchs. I've been calling for months now for the kind of punishing sanctions that Joe Biden and Western leaders keep promising but never revealing. Permanently canceling the Nord Stream 2 pipeline, not just shuffling some bureaucratic paper around its review. Imposing sanctions on Russia's oil and gas sectors, its mineral and mining sectors, the critical industries in that country, clamping down on its financial industry and its access to the international banking systems. These are the kind of sanctions that are called for now, not these quarter measures that were just announced or that Berlin announced earlier today about Nord Stream 2. I mean, unfortunately, the administration spent the first 24 hours debating whether to even call this invasion an invasion, and the president took 80 minutes to come out for his own press conference, which doesn't exactly project confidence and certainty and resolution to people watching in Moscow. So much more is called for right now, John, than what we just heard.
Yeah, it's actually not deterring anything, and Putin has made a judgment about the West that he will accept whatever mosquito bites of sanctions that have come up thus far. And the thing that Senator Cotton said that is so true is that the Russians did not dismantle Nord Stream. They didn't sign a piece of paper. And Putin knows that the infrastructure is there, and when they get cold, they'll sign the piece of paper. Jennifer Griffin, a terrific reporter with Fox News Channel, talking to Brett Baer last night, cut 19.
Putin has options tonight militarily, but if Putin opts for a full invasion, the justification of which he laid out in his speech today, here's what we can expect to see. Electronic warfare combined with cyber attacks will disaggregate and paralyze the Ukraine government and military. Anything on the communication, GPS, or magnetic spectrum will go dark. This period of pre-assault fire would then be followed by salvos of ballistic missiles, those Iskander missile units in Belarus. Russian fourth and fifth generation attack aircraft will then flood the airspace. Think blitzkrieg, waves of attacks that will look like U.S. shock and awe at the start of the U.S. invasion of Iraq, targeting air defense systems, command and control sites. The next wave will include tube artillery and rocket launchers, likely in the wee hours of the morning. Then he will insert his special forces, who we are told have target lists of Ukrainian journalists and civil society leaders. Tonight, Brett, we are witnessing the beginning of the end of the post-Cold War architecture, which ensured a rules-based order, stability, and respect for the sovereignty of nations. The world must now brace itself for what follows.
Jennifer Griffin has exactly the right tone that I think eludes people like the Metternich of MSNBC, Ben Rhodes, cut number 16, talking to Andrea Mitchell.
I think, again, the challenge here is Vladimir Putin doesn't seem to care. He knew that these sanctions were coming. I think the U.S. had communicated to Russia precisely the kind of sanctions that would be coming. So I don't think he's in any way caught off guard by this announcement.
Remembering very well, as I will be talking later with HR McMaster, the red line that Ben and Barack Obama erased in Syria, he doesn't really have to worry about the West because he's dealing with a Democratic president. And it is that clear. ABC News war correspondent Ian Pinnell last night talking about Putin cut 17.
We've seen Russian sanctions imposed on Russia in the past, and they haven't had the desired effect. I really have serious questions as to whether or not this is going to stop Putin. The tone from what we've heard would suggest it probably won't.
It probably won't. Deputy National Security Advisor John Feiner was on CNN on Monday and on Tuesday. Here he is on Monday night, refusing to say that Russia is beginning an invasion, cut number 14.
If Putin is putting troops in Donbass, he calls them peacekeeping, but they are military troops. Do you define that as an invasion?
So what President Putin has done already today is something that we are appalled by, but not surprised by. The entire spectacle that unfolded in Moscow was more or less predicted publicly by President Biden in some of his comments, by Secretary of State Tony Blinken in his comments to the UN Security Council, and something we were prepared to respond to, and indeed already have responded to, through an executive order that this administration put out tonight. We have also said that we plan to take additional actions tomorrow. In terms of what is actually happening on the ground in the Donbas region of Ukraine, we have seen reports, but we are basing our actions on what Russia actually does, not the statements that Russia makes. We're going to continue to assess overnight any steps that Russia takes, and we will be prepared with a significant response tomorrow.
Okay, so let me just understand, though, then, just the basics. I understand you're waiting to see if they actually walk over the line. But the Secretary of State, of course, Tony Blinken, said very specifically on January 21st that if Russian forces move across the border into Ukraine, it's a, quote, renewed invasion. So this would be, if one troop walks over that border or drives over, however it is, a renewed invasion, correct?
So I'm going to repeat what I just said, which is we are not going based on what Russia has stated. I understand they've made a statement about deploying.
I understand they haven't done it yet. But if they I'm sorry, we have a bit of a delay. I don't mean to be talking over you. But if a troop comes over that border, if that happens in the next 2 hours or 3 hours or whatever it is, when that happens, is that an invasion?
What I'm telling you is that we will be prepared with a significant response tomorrow based on whatever it is Russia
does. So that's Monday night. Tuesday night, he goes on to say, okay, now we're set. This is so weak. Remember, Moscow is watching all this. He's the Deputy National Security Advisor. He looks like the model UN kid. Cut number 15.
So you called this the beginning of the latest Russian invasion of Ukraine. Is that different than an invasion?
I think latest is important here. An invasion is an invasion, and that is what is underway. But Russia has been invading Ukraine since 2014. They've been occupying large pieces of Ukraine since 2014, including, although they've denied it, Russian troop presence in exactly the two what they now call republics, but that are really provinces of a sovereign Ukraine that they recognized yesterday. So Russia is essentially making overt what it has denied for some time, which is Russian troop presence in these places, and we are taking steps.
Enough of Jonathan Feiner. We now know that we don't have to watch Jonathan Feiner. He's the guy they send out whenever they don't know what to say, and he goes, abba-dabba-dabba-dabba. Wall Street Journal editorial this morning, at least the administration overcame its initial reluctance, that would be Mr. Feiner, to call Vladimir Putin's deployment of troops in eastern Ukraine as an invasion. Mr. Biden on Tuesday called it the beginning of a Russian invasion. He responded with what he said was the beginning of greater sanctions. The White House bet seemed to be that the sanctions restraint will cause Mr. Putin to settle for holding his the region his forces now occupy and foregoing an assault on Kyiv. But the Russian has never been deterred by Western restraint in the past. He may see this as more weakness. Of course he sees it as more weakness. People have got to focus not on what Jonathan Feiner at the NSC says, not at what President Biden says at a press conference in which he takes no questions because he cannot give good, resolute answers. They got to focus on the killer that is Putin. I've got a new column in the Washington Post on this. The killer that is Xi, the killer that is Putin, the killer that is Ayatollah Khamenei, are the new axis of evil. Those three people are killers. You can't believe a word they say. They stand there. They're just going to do what they do until they get stopped. And right now it's up to the Ukrainian military to stop them, and we got to be sending everything that can fly to help them stop them, because there's going to be a war, because there's been nothing said by Joe Biden that would in any way intimidate the Russians. I want to go back to his Ukraine address yesterday. Cut number three.
Yesterday, the world heard clearly the full extent of Vladimir Putin's twisted rewrite of history. Going back more than a century, as he waxed eloquently, noting that Well, I'm not going to go into it, but nothing in Putin's lengthy remarks.
He can't read a prompter. He said eloquently, I mean, he can't read a prompter. The President of the United States, you know, Vladimir Putin, has judged him not capable of responding coherently. And he's right. I'll be right back, America. What do you think? 1-800-520-1234. 1-800-520-1234. Connection to the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Birch Gold Group.
This is Hugh Hewitt for townhall.com. Buckle up for 2022. The year in politics is going to be rough. The midterm election year seems predestined to banish the Democratic majorities in both houses of Congress. The country senses infirmity in President Biden, and many worry that our adversaries in China, Russia, and Iran sense that opening too. The shadow campaign for the GOP nomination in 2024 opens now, with a clear frontrunner being former President Donald Trump. The ranks of the top tier among possible GOP presidential nominees in alphabetical order starts with two senators, Arkansas's Tom Cotton and Ted Cruz of Texas. Then we have the populist Florida Governor Ron DeSantis, the former Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, and South Carolina Senator Tim Scott. If the world grows even darker in the days to come, Cotton and Pompeo, two former soldiers, start with some advantages. It's possible one or more will run whether or not the former president does. My bet, with 3 years to go, is that Trump runs and runs hard. Buckle up. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
publicpolicy.pepperdine.edu. Trending now on the Larry Elder Show.
The Supreme Court has said is you have to have a compelling state interest, and the compelling state interest that the Supreme Court found was the benefits that flow from having a diverse student body, whatever those benefits may be. But you have to have a diverse student body to get these certain benefits, okay? So that justifies this kind of racial alchemy in terms of admissions. Here's the problem. Increasingly at schools, you have, regardless of how supposedly integrated they are, you're getting more and more racial separatism, separate classes, separate dormitories, separate graduations. There's more and more of that going on. And one of the basic reasons for that is because of mismatch, because of the serious mismatch in academic qualifications between Asians, Latinos, Blacks, and whites.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
You want to know what's even crazier and funnier in a sick way? There's a security guard right there. The shoplifter, the looter, walks right by the security guard who isn't doing anything. He's got a jacket on with a big security on the back of his coat. And he stands there and watches the guy. The guy literally brushes right by the security guard. The security guard, what are they paying the security guard for? Just to stand there? Why don't we just put mannequins up in stores in New York? I may never go back. I swear, I may never go back. New York is turning into a hellhole. And Democrats are watching it. They're letting it happen. I can't wait to get Joe Borelli's take on all of this insanity.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
You called your son. You personally promised him you would be here.
Lucas, I don't know how to help you.
Your daddy loves you. You gotta know him, pal. Do you feel
the love? Prayer is a powerful thing, Ethan. It really does work, if you believe.
What reason does he have to care about some guy who's supposed to be his dad, but he's never around?
I can't do it again. I'm not ready for this, man.
I'm done with you.
We all deserve a second chance, right, Ethan?
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
This is Carol Platt Liebau for townhall.com.
Welcome back, America. It's Hugh Hewitt. In Ukraine, President Zelensky has introduced conscription of reservists in a special period, unnamed how long it will go for, but he did not invoke the general mobilization. They have about a 500,000 people they can generally mobilize, and I don't know how many conscripts it means. He's being very clear-eyed, as is his foreign minister, who gave remarks yesterday. Dmytro Kuleba, I believe is his name. Cut number 13.
We meet at a very tense and responsible time for Ukraine, for the United States, and for the world. We all are at a critical juncture for the security of Europe, as well as international peace and security more broadly. Russian aggression has brought the world to the edge of the largest catastrophe since World War II. Yesterday, President Putin moved to recognize two pieces of Ukrainian land as independent entities. Ukraine does not and will never recognize this absurdity. Neither will the world recognize it. In fact, what Putin recognized is not the so-called Donetsk People's Republic and Luhansk People's Republic. He recognized his direct responsibility for the war against Ukraine and an unprovoked and unjustified war on another sovereign state in Europe, which Russia now intensifies.
He's absolutely right. There's just no joking about this. And how the West, I think the West responded tepidly. Great Britain sanctioned three oligarchs. How many are there? 300? I would put, if I were the United Kingdom, I would publish a list of all the oligarchs and the United States living in the country and say, we're going to take out five more, and not take out, but move out five more of these every day that Putin is involved. So here's a list of 300. Here's the first five that go. We'll up that number and send more the next day, and then the next day. Just create problems for Putin at home. That's the only thing that works. Speaking of problems at home, masks in schools. Districts get caught between health authorities and parent pushback. And this is all about Columbus, where the school district says, but the public health officer says we can't take off the masks, and the parents are mad at him. Here's the deal. If you're an elected official, you do not answer to the public health authority. If you're an elected official, you answer to those who elected you. School districts need to tell their superintendents to dump the mask mandate, to make it optional. Can't make kids not wear a mask. You ought to allow children to take them off, and teachers should be unmasked. And you are elected officials. You cannot blame it on the... It's just not going to work, school districts. You know what else is not going to work? American Express is undertaking race-conscious hiring. And so a new sponsor of this show is called UnAmericanExpress.com, UnAmericanExpress.com. In their 2021 Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Report, American Express essentially said it would hire and promote employees based on race and gender. They are also pushing employees to join groups based on religion, race, and other demographics. They're even disavowing capitalism. There's nothing about American, about what American Express is doing. And so Color Us United is taking up the fight against American Express with this simple message. Choose woke values or classic American values. You can't choose both. American Express is the wokest of the woke. And now pushing back, unamericanexpress.com. Go to unamericanexpress.com to discover what it is exactly you can do to fight back against the use of race and gender and class and religion against your fellow citizens. Un-American Express, it's crazy. Wokeism has got them completely. On the markets yesterday, Ukraine, it continues to play havoc. Birch Gold is where you're going to want to go. Gold is around $1,900 going there. And if there's a full-scale invasion, expect it to go up, up, up. There is an invasion. There's no doubt about it. And gold has gone up with international tensions, as it traditionally does. If you want to move a portion of your IRA or 401k over to a Birch Gold IRA or 401k, all you have to do is go to HughGold.com. Great sponsor of the show, and have been for years, who I buy my gold from, or text my name, Hugh, to 989898. We're not going to have clarity on what's going on with gold, other than inflationary pressures are still there, whether or not Putin is trying to start World War III. So head over to birchgold.com, get the information on opening up a 401k or a SEP IRA using real gold maintained and preserved by Birch Gold. Hugh to 989898. Text Hugh to 989898. Stay tuned.
This is Carol Platt-Lebow for townhall.com. Sometimes there are policies so destructive that at first you don't believe they're true. Joe Biden is currently defending one, his plan to award $450,000 to migrants separated from their families after entering the U.S. illegally. Children of deceased U.S. soldiers are separated from their parents permanently. They don't receive this kind of money. And migrants who enter the U.S. legally certainly don't get this kind of payout. The really big jackpot, it seems, is being reserved for the lawbreakers. There are some obvious truths here. First, behavior that's subsidized gets repeated. Joe Biden is effectively inviting many more illegal immigrants to breach America's open borders. Second, he's betting over time the payoffs will benefit his party in political terms. Meanwhile, the vast majority of Americans watch in shock and dismay as our president, the country's chief law enforcement officer, brazenly rewards lawbreaking, a clear violation of his oath to defend our nation's laws. It's a sorry sight indeed.
Trending now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
It seems like the Democrats tried their best to try to eliminate the filibuster, and it failed. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, thankfully, it did fail. Republicans stood united against that, as we have been from the very beginning, and Kyrsten Sinema and Joe Manchin also stood with us in preserving the rules and the customs of the Senate. These rules and customs go back more than 200 years, Charlie. They are directly downstream from why our founders created a Senate in the first place, to provide the sober second thought against radical sweeping change to our country. It's pretty amazing that 48 out of 50 Democrats were willing to blow up the filibuster. They were willing to break the rules to change the rules. And Charlie, that would have just been the first step towards redistributing political power in this country. The Democrats' next stop probably would have been to make Washington, D.C. a state, our federal city that is by far the most liberal jurisdiction in America. So the Democrats could get two more Democratic senators in perpetuity. The next stop would have been to pack our federal courts, to include the Supreme Court, to stop the courts from overturning any of these unconstitutional actions. This entire effort, Charlie, was not about just altering this or that public policy. It was about forever changing the structure of political power in our country. You sometimes heard the argument that, well, the Democrats shouldn't do this because the shoe was on their other foot. Their entire goal was to make sure, Charlie, the shoe would never be on the other foot. So it was a critical day in the history of our country and the history of the Senate as an institution. And I'm glad we stopped these radicals. That's why we have to turn them out of power in November.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
This really is a Leninist strategy. Lenin's old saying that the capitalists will sell us the rope by which we will hang them is what China's doing. The Soviets couldn't do it for a couple reasons. Number one, they didn't have the money. They didn't have a whole lot of rubles to throw around, and people in the West didn't want them. But number two, there was a lot bigger sense of social cohesion during the Cold War. The notion, if you're a corporate executive during the Cold War, that you would be playing footsies with the Kremlin was outrageous. And yet in the case of China, the human rights situation, the challenge to American national security, is every bit as great, I would argue perhaps even greater than it was in the Cold War era. But Wall Street, Silicon Valley, they are all happy to not only do deals with them, but do deals with them that benefit the Chinese military and intelligence state. And they don't seem to particularly care that they do.
Well, there was stigma in helping the Soviets. There's no stigma in helping the Chinese communists.
That's right. And I think that, you know, part of that is there's been this naivete for decades that if we just gave China money, if we gave them access to our technology, they were going to buy our blue jeans, they were going to watch some of our movies, they would become just like us. What's really happened, when you look at issues like censorship by big tech in the United States, when you look at some of the other things that are going on, it's not that China's become more like us. We've actually become more like China. And that experiment has to fade away. And the problem is, not only were our elites wrong in their prescription of that policy, but that policy made them rich. And they do not want to now give up those relationships with Beijing because it means the money is going to stop flowing.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. The Democrats have an agenda. Inflation at home, appeasement abroad, teachers unions first, students last, open border and closed schools. It's a very, very easy to see objective and agenda. And now we add to it appeasement. I'm joined by Senator Rick Scott of Florida, chairman of the National Republican Senatorial Committee. Good morning, Senator Scott. How are you?
Good morning. It's a scary time in the world when we have such a weak president, and we have Democrats that have gone off and now are controlled by the radical left.
Now, I want to begin with the headline over at Politico this morning, Senator Scott, because I don't think it's true. It's Politico. It's left-wing. Republicans descend into foreign policy factionalism over Russia-Ukraine standoff. This is an attempt, I think, to sow discord in a united caucus that Joe Biden is weak. Is there any disagreement among the caucus that Joe Biden is simply an appeasement president?
He's an appeasement president, and he didn't do anything to hold Russia accountable. He's scared to death of holding Russia accountable. What Republicans believe is you have to hold these thugs accountable. I mean, we shouldn't have approved Nord Stream 2. There should have been sanctions on Putin before he invaded, and they ought to be tougher now. So that's exactly where Republicans are. We all know that we're stuck three more years with a very weak president, and we've got a Democrat House and Senate that won't hold these thugs accountable and won't even hold our president accountable.
You know, after Bill Clinton lost his majority in 94, he began to agree with a Republican Congress. Do you think the same thing will happen with President Biden? Will he have to up his game if we've got the House and the Senate, Senator Scott?
Well, I believe we're going to get the House and the Senate. I hope he does. I hope he wants to work with us. But if you look at the people he's appointed, they're radical left people. You look at the people around him, they're militant left people. They're defund the police people. They want government to run everything. It's the big leftist woke crowd that's all around him.
Well, let me also go to the second Politico article this morning. Rick Scott pushes own GOP agenda as McConnell holds off. Now, I talked to both of you, and I know that this isn't true, but this is what you're going to run into, Senator. An attempt to sow discord where there isn't. There's only different variations of the same opinion condemning the president's weakness. But what do you say to Politico when they say Rick Scott pushes own GOP agenda as McConnell holds off?
Well, first off, I completely agree with Mitch McConnell that the election's generally going to be about the Biden agenda. And I think the Biden agenda is so unpopular, we're going to have a great November. We both agree that, you know, candidates need to have a plan of what they're going to do when they get into the Senate or in the House. And so I put out my ideas. There will be other ideas. I have an 11-step plan. You can go see it at rescueamerica.com, rescueamerica.com, or text America to 22044, 22044. So you can look at it. Give me your ideas. I'm sure there's things you don't agree with. There are things that we're going to have to add. There are things that, you know, that we're going to improve on. But I believe it's important that all of our candidates be talking about what they want to do. It's not the NRSC plan. It's the Rick Scott plan. It's what I believe in. I'm a business guy. I'm a plan guy. In my business life, I create plans. I work my plans. That's how I had success as governor. I ran on a very specific plan. I implemented the plan, and we turned Florida around. I hope to do the same thing with the federal government. We've got to rescue this country.
Now, your plan's got to center on 7 Senate seats: Missouri, New Hampshire, Georgia, Nevada, Pennsylvania, Ohio, and Arizona. So as I do when I talk to you at least once a month, Senator, I want to go through them. In New Hampshire, do we have 1, 2, or 3 viable candidates? And I don't want to mess around with people who are running for 1% or, you know, first time in, that sort of thing. Yeah. How many viable candidates have we got in New Hampshire?
I think a lot of people believe that Chuck Morris and Kevin Smith are going to have a good primary. One of them will win, and we'll beat Maggie Hassan in November. They're great candidates. This is a great cycle for us, and Maggie Hassan is underwater on her fave on face.
Do they have an early primary in New Hampshire, Senator?
No, it's late, and I talked to this, you know, retired Senator Judd Gregg about that. He says he thinks it's going to be good for us because we're going to be in the news. Maggie Hassan is completely defined. So he's, you know, it's late. I think it's September even. Maybe it's our latest one. And he feels good that, you know, we have a great chance of winning there. And both Chuck Morris and Kevin Smith, there's another individual in the race, General Bolduc, but we're going to have a good candidate there.
Now, in Arizona, I moderated a debate 2.5 weeks ago. 4 out of the 5 candidates, Mark Brnovich, the Attorney General, did not participate. He was prepping for the Supreme Court case. I think he's arguing today. That doesn't look to me like any of those 5 are going away before August. So that's a long, drawn-out-in-the-desert battle. Is that good in your eyes?
Well, it'd be nice if we had a candidate earlier, but that's not reality. The positive is Mark Kelly is now defined as Chuck Schumer. Chuck Schumer's not popular in Arizona. If you look at a generic ballot, you say Mark Kelly or a Republican wins. And so we're going to have a primary. We've got great people in the primary. One of them will be the victor. And there's no reason, if we run a good race, we raise our money, there's no reason we can't win out there. Now we got to raise our money. Mark Kelly's raising a lot of money. So we're going to have to raise our money out there. So I hope people get involved and help whoever they believe is the best candidate.
Now, in Missouri is the race in which I've taken a position, so I can't moderate a debate. I don't think Eric Greitens can win in Missouri, but there are other candidates who can. Has President Trump endorsed in that race, Senator Scott?
No, he's not endorsed. I'd be surprised if he does. Josh Hall endorsed Vicky Hartzler, and Ted Cruz endorsed Eric Smith. You know, Billy Long's in the race also.
That's Democrat, Cortez Masto. You agree with me on that?
Absolutely. We've done a poll at the NRSC. There's public polls to show Adam Laxalt beating Cortez Masto. Schumer's already spending money to try to beef up Cortez Masto. It's not working. You know, Adam has a primary, but Adam right now is way ahead in his primary. So I think Adam will be the next senator from Nevada.
Now, Georgia is where Herschel. I've been down to do an event with Herschel, interview him. I'm not endorsing him. I know there might be other people in there. But it does seem to me that he is inevitably going to be the nominee, and he's going to have to match up against Raphael Warnock, who is fiery, right? You've gotten to know Pastor Warnock. He's fiery. Will that work in Georgia? I think, actually, the Democrats are underwater in Georgia bigly, and they're hoping on a governor primary to destroy the GOP, but it ain't going to happen.
Well, we're going to win. It's still a Republican state. We're going to be able to find Warnock. Right now, you're right. Herschel Walker's leading in the primary by a long shot. You know, he's run his race. I know he's working hard to make sure he knows the issues well. Here's the only negative. Warnock's raising a lot of money, so we've got to all do everything we can to help Herschel Walker or anybody else. If you have another candidate in the primary you like better, but we've got to help them because we've got to make sure that they have the resources to win.
All right, now let's go to the 2 that are very difficult to do, Pennsylvania and Ohio. Let's save Ohio for last. Pennsylvania, you have 3 great candidates. I mean, I've had all 3 on the show. They're all great. What do you do? They have an early primary, though, don't they?
Yeah, there's I can't remember the exact date, but theirs is earlier. And you know, they, you know, some of these states are changing because of the redistricting. But we've got very good candidates in Pennsylvania. They're going to have a very heated primary. It's already started. They have the resources to do that. But whoever has the best ideas and works the hardest, they're going to come out. And look, we can win there because the logical, you know, either it doesn't matter who is on the other side, they're going to be a Bernie Sanders type candidate on the Democrat side. So it's a state that we should win. If we run a good race, then we're going to win there.
All right. Last one is Ohio, my home state. Now, Bernie Moreno dropped out this week. Kellyanne Conway and Rob Portman joined up with Jane Timken. Does that in any way foreshadow a Trump endorsement? Does it give you any sense of which way that race is going?
You know, Trump might endorse in that state. I'd actually be surprised. You know, there's, you know, if they're going to have, they've got great people in the primary. I can say good things about every one of the candidates in there. So I think it'll be interesting to see who wins there, but it's still a Republican state. And so, you know, their candidate will be a Bernie Sanders type candidate. He'll try to be, you know, the Democrat candidate will try to go to the middle, but he's not. He's a lefty. And so we just have to have our money and define him.
So I went over to rescueamerica.com, Senator. I want to read to the audience what the statement says that you say. America is waking up to the gross incompetence of the Biden administration and the extremism of the woke left. Check, check. Among the things the militant left planned to change or destroy are American history, check, patriotism, check, border security, check, Christianity, check, the nuclear family, check, gender, check, traditional morality, check, capitalism, check, fiscal responsibility, check, opportunity, well, opportunity as you and I understand it, Senator, they have opportunity for government people, rugged individualism, the Judeo-Christian ethic, dissent, free speech, colorblindness, law enforcement, religious liberty, and private ownership of firearms. That's quite a list. So I am confused only, Senator, at rescueamerica.com. How is it mixed up with WinRed?
Well, WinRed is for a campaign. WinRed is where you can go and help whoever you believe. We raise money through WinRed for the NRSC. This is what I personally believe, totally separate than my job as chairman of the NRSC. This is what I personally believe we ought to be talking about. We ought to be very clear. When you elect, when you elect me, this is what I'm going to try to do. I know every candidate's going to have their own version of this. They're going to talk about what they're going to do when they get up here, but I think it's important that Republicans have a plan of what they're going to accomplish when we get the majority back, which I believe we will.
RescueAmerica.com. And what's the text number, Rick Scott?
It's text America to 22044.
America 22044. Did I get that right?
Yes, that's it.
Good to talk to you, Senator. I'm off to your state today, to the free state of Florida. I've never been to Fort Lauderdale today, so I'm going to touch down in Fort Lauderdale later today, and I doubt I'll see you in the airport, but safe travels to you, too.
All right. Take care. I'll be close.
All right. Relieffactor.com, America. It's time for me. Like I said, I'm getting on an airplane, and that always means, and I only travel light. I have to make one of these dashes across the country. It's a backpack and no luggage because you don't want to wait for a luggage carousel. Nevertheless, you got to put it over your head, and that means watch out for your back. So I carry in Kirkman and Resveratrol Omega. I have learned that airplanes are the worst thing in America for back. Now, I don't think they're particularly bad for COVID or anything else. I think they're really bad. It's like a back COVID when you go on an airplane. People take these ridiculously heavy overhead bags and they put them up in the wrong angle in a small area. I just inveigh against airline cargo bins. Now, they've changed it, by the way. There's a new plane. Only like 0.1% of our planes have this new cargo thing that makes it easy, actually, to load your overhead bag. And who checks baggage? Really, who checks baggage? Dwayne is going to France with us so we can broadcast from the boat. And he told me he had 8 pieces of luggage. And then Chris Ann has got another 10. And so we got 18 pieces of luggage from Dwayne and Chris Ann. That's not going to fit in the overhead bin, Dwayne. So we're going to make sure one of those pieces of luggage has enough relief factor to float us all the way through France. And with Dwayne in my ear, I'm going to need a lot of relief factor because my back is going to hurt from carrying him around on this trip. He doesn't do well on the water. He told me that. I expect him not to be able to produce much, but to be leaning over the side of the rail. But we'll get relieffactor.com for him. Don't you forget it. I just took it. You can go get it for $19.95. When we come back, I'm going to talk with Salena Zito about what do they think in Yinzerland about Russia invading Ukraine. Stay tuned, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Color Us United.
Streaming on Salem Now. For Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com. Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com. Streaming on Salem Now.
The Democratic Party somehow has convinced black people that they're the good guys. Never mind the skanky history of the Democratic Party. That was a party of slavery.
He said, listen, I gotta give these niggas enough. Not too much, but enough that I have them voting Democrat for the next 200 years.
The race grievance industry would have you believe that blacks get up and think about nothing else except race.
If I tell you this is racist, yeah. I would get you emotional.
There is a whole big cottage industry for racism. If racism went away, a lot of people would be unemployed.
The mob during the Minneapolis riots following the death of George Floyd, a bunch of white thugs, frankly, burning down the city's traditional black and Asian business district.
They're racist, 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 racist. Everything's racist.
It's the devil!
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Trending now on the Eric Metaxas Show.
When you have nobody calls him on it, it's really something that I think they're going to consume their own.
The Democratic Party knows that they're in trouble. When you say that their staff sees what's going on and we all see it, we got to remember one other thing. Vladimir Putin, Premier Xi, the leader of North Korea, the leader of Iran, these people all see it too. And there is a message being sent globally that America is a laughingstock right now, that the bowl of mashed potatoes that serves as the president in the White House right now is nothing more than a suit.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Salena Zito, of course, from Yinzerland. We couldn't have our Yinzer report on Monday because it was President's Day. And I like to point out, Pennsylvania's never had a president, and Ohio has most of them. And in Pennsylvania, it's true. Why is that? I don't know why you can't produce a president, Salena. What is the problem there?
We have produced two, but I really don't want to comment on either Buchanan or Biden at this moment.
Well, you don't count Biden as a president. He's not from Scranton. He's a Delaware president. I mean, not just passing through. And Buchanan is the worst president in the history of the United States. You're going to really lay claim to him? He's a Southerner in Pennsylvania disguise.
No, so that's what, yes, you guys have had many great presidents.
Many great presidents, because it's Ohio. The good people come across the river. Salena, I want to know, around your neck of the woods, as we say in our neck of the woods, what do people think about what's going on in Russia, Ukraine, and what Biden is doing and the United States is not doing?
You know, people are really just distraught by how the West, or how we have gotten ourselves in this position. And the failure of a strong diplomacy has just sort of led us down this path. I mean, that is sort of, if you crowdsourced people's opinions, that is where we are right now. They just cannot believe, or actually they can believe, they don't want to believe that this is the position that we find ourselves in.
Now, if I'm not mistaken, you'll find a lot of Ukrainian Americans in our two states. You'll also find them up through Michigan and into Minnesota. It's where Ukrainian Americans came when they got out of the old country, by and large. So there's a lot of Orthodox churches, et cetera, Deer Hunter, et cetera. What, have you heard from any of these people what's happening as their country gets threatened by the thug?
Yeah, you hear about their, I mean, as you point out, a lot of migrated here a century ago during that Great Migration, and the beautiful churches are dotted all through the hills around here, and there's a lot of still connection, and they still have family there, and you know, people are deeply concerned because of the aggression that Russia has shown. But you know, they have been worried about this since 8 years ago during the Obama administration, when Russia went after Crimea, and we didn't even blink.
No, we didn't. Now, I am curious what you think the reaction is to the framing of President Trump's statement yesterday to Buck Sexton. Made it sound like he was admiring of Putin. I don't believe he is. I think he is like George C. Scott saying, "Rommel, Rommel, you magnificent blink. I read your book." That's what he's saying, but that's not what's being reported. What do people believe President Trump said?
They don't think that statement was an admiration of Putin. They do think it's an acknowledgement that is who he's acknowledging who Putin is.
It resonates with anyone who's seen the movie. But if you haven't seen the movie, George C. Scott is playing Patton.
Yeah.
It's a tank battle. They destroy Rommel, and he said, "Rommel, you magnificent blank. I read your book." Yes. He doesn't think he's a magnificent blank. He thinks he's a very talented, evil guy.
Yes, absolutely. Unfortunately, the press has still not figured out that thing I said in 2016 where people take him seriously but not literally.
Right.
But the press, the people that want to interpret Trump as the most evil possible are always going to take everything that he says and put it in a category that is unacceptable in polite society.
I have been noticing this all night long, thinking to myself, everybody knows he doesn't mean to approve of Putin. Everybody knows that, and yet you couldn't get away from that interpretation of his comments yesterday. He does not approve of Putin's legacy, does not approve of Putin's thuggery, his invasion. He simply is commenting on his tactics in the way that Patton might have commented on Rommel's tactics. They're enemies. They're enemies, but they talk to each other. I don't understand the obsession. And we're in the middle of a world coming apart in Europe, and I want to give you the last minute, and our press is focused on a former president.
It's astounding. You know, I was flipping through channels yesterday, and two of our three channels were doing nothing but still obsessing about Trump and or not even talking about Ukraine, but talking about Trump.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, there's a reason y'all are losing viewers and people are turning their televisions off. Is because you have this unbelievable obsession with this man.
It's an addiction.
He's gone. He's not president. He's not president.
It's Trump addiction. He's not the president. He's not particularly eloquent either. But at the same time, Putin didn't invade Ukraine on his watch. I think that's what this is all about, is they know that's the inescapable fact, but we will see. SelenaZito.com for all of Selena's commentary, including her latest on the Republican Senate race candidate David McCormick over at Washington Examiner. I just tweeted out one. Come back for hour two of the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Trending now on the Larry Elder Show.
You let that happen for 10 weeks of your children being kept in a box in the library, excluded, put on display, and so on and so forth for that long. I kind of feel like, and I can tell you are a very caring mom, which is why you're bringing this public, but I kind of feel like that would happen for 2 hours, and I would be down there at that school and pulling my kid out, much less 2 to 10 weeks. Did they really endure that for that long?
They really did that for that long, and I really appreciate that question, and I've gotten that question a lot, and how we looked at it as a family is we could pull them and just go about our lives, and they'll just do this to someone else, or we could stay and fight and hold our ground. And my kids didn't want to leave that school. They've been in that school, my son, since first grade to eighth grade. They had their friends there. We still had hope that the trusted adults would do the right thing. And we eventually have pulled them to homeschool. But during those weeks, we were fighting. We have hundreds of emails to the administration, the Dallas ISD school board. We went down and I brought 30 or 40 grandmas and grandpas and other parents from other schools down to fight and speak on our behalf. Parents even scheduled protests, 3 protests outside the school. So we were fighting, but I think at this point in our country, the war has come into the family, and our kids can no longer be shielded from it. They need to be guided through it, which we did as a family, to build a backbone and learn how to stand up and fight, because this is their next generation. So instead of shielding them from it, we help them move through it with grace, integrity, and dignity, and they came out stronger.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
You called your son and you personally promised him you would be here.
Prayer is a powerful thing, Ethan. It really does work if you believe.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
This is Hugh Hewitt for townhall.com. Buckle up for 2022. The year in politics is going to be rough. The midterm election year seems predestined to banish the Democratic majorities in both houses of Congress. The country senses infirmity in President Biden, and many worry that our adversaries in China, Russia, and Iran sense that opening too. The shadow campaign for the GOP nomination in 2024 opens now, with a clear frontrunner being former President Donald Trump. The ranks of the top tier among possible GOP presidential nominees in alphabetical order starts with 2 senators, Arkansas's Tom Cotton and Ted Cruz of Texas. Then we have the populist Florida Governor Ron DeSantis, the former Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, and South Carolina Senator Tim Scott. If the world grows even darker in the days to come, Cotton and Pompeo, 2 former soldiers, start with some advantages. It's possible one or more will run whether or not the former president does. My bet, with 3 years to go, is that Trump runs and runs hard. Buckle up. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
Publicpolicy.pepperdine.edu. Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
Look at you! Ow! Hey, look at that! I wasn't ready for that.
And there goes Peter Dinklage beating the crap out of Will Ferrell for calling him an angry elf. I mean, listen, he's certainly not an elf, but he's an angry guy. You know, I hate to put everything in a political perspective here, but isn't it true? And I assume Peter Dinklage is no conservative. He's woke. He wants to cancel Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. Why do they always want to cancel everything? You know, They want to cancel everything. What do conservatives believe in? We are for things. Biden's always saying, "What are Republicans for? Not for anything." Yes, we're for everything. We're for people. We're for people's right to make decisions about their health. We're for movies. We're for different views on the airwaves. We're not for people being canceled or movies being canceled or things being canceled. We're for things. And your side, Biden, is against everything. You're against Snow White and the Seven Dwarves. Oh, I mean, Disney obviously taking it seriously because they're redoing the whole movie, I guess. Do you portray them as children? Should child actors play the Seven Dwarves? You going to get little Billy or Susie, who's about 9? The Seven Dwarves in Snow White aren't children. Grumpy isn't a kid. I mean, in fact, that would be a great, if they're casting people, maybe Peter Dinklage can play Grumpy. Because he fit right in.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
So I think in their strategy meeting, they said, okay, people say that Joe Biden's mental decline is impacting his ability to govern. Let's shoot Joe up with whatever sort of kind of adrenaline that is necessary and deploy him out there. I think the point was to try to show that Joe Biden was going to go over the top long to try to win kudos and praise from the establishment media. This is his first press conference I think he's done in quite some time. Some people said it was his first ever press conference as president. Second? Okay. That was his second press conference. Trump used to do these almost daily. He did them for fun. And I will say, for reasons that we can speculate, the media was pretty critical. They were direct, precise. Now, nowhere even in the ecosystem, nowhere even in the atmosphere of questions towards Donald Trump. And I agree with my friend Tucker Carlson, the press conference was totally weird. It was a strange deal. Joe Biden leaning in, he does this thing where he kind of like hunches over the podium. You notice that, Connor? And he kind of puts both of his arms down and he looks directly at the reporter. And then he whispers, you're exactly right. And he was still calling from a pre-selected list of reporters. And there were multiple blunders that came out of that. But if the point was to try to show the nation, look, hey, if you have any concerns about how sharp this guy is mentally, I mean, come on. He stood there and talked for 2 hours. I don't think that mission was accomplished.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe.
Streaming on Salem Now.
The public would be outraged if they knew the truth.
Why do you think our politicians are not on the sidewalk right now talking to you?
No, I have no respect.
The old wall randomly turns into a guardrail, followed by miles of open border.
Human trafficking, but
that journey is extremely dangerous.
The 7-year-old girl died in the desert
from the country of India.
A great pillar of the community was killed by a man who had been deported at least twice.
This little urn contains the ashes of my son. His dreams cut short forever.
We're so worried about other countries' problems, and we don't even focus on our own.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com. Streaming on Salem Now.
Thank you.
Morning Glory America, bonjour, hi Canada. The latest breaking news, Ukraine has declared a nationwide state of emergency. A full-scale invasion is coming in the next 24 hours, according to Australian Prime Minister Scott Morrison. Breaking news always first when we get it here at the Hugh Hewitt Show. I'm joined by Jake Sherman of Punchbowl News. Now, Punchbowl News is very interesting this morning because it's like the March of the Doomed. Representative Susan Wild, Representative Josh Gottheimer, Representative Dan Kildee of Michigan, Mike Levin of California, the list goes on and on. Mickey Sherrill of New Jersey, Andy Kim of New Jersey, Stephen Horsford of Nevada, Susie Lee of Nevada. Honestly, this is like a casualty list, Jake.
Well, we wanted to, our goal here, and you're referring to our special edition, which digs into the race for the House of Representatives.
Yes.
Our goal was to get people on the record on what they think of Biden and how they're going to campaign in 2022. And Democrat, listen, Hugh, the reality is this, and if you don't, not you, if one doesn't want to admit this, then they're lying to themselves and they're not being honest about the climate. Obviously, Democrats are behind the eight ball in 2022. Whether you want to admit that or not is up to you. And our goal was to try to elucidate how some of these people are thinking about it. I mean, we don't feel, I'll just give you a sense into our thinking really quickly. I said, I hope not to bore you here. We try to be even and fair. We're not looking, but that doesn't mean that you can't state that Democrats are likely to lose the House.
That's right. I mean, you asked Tom Emmer the hard questions. You asked Maloney the hard questions. It's just asking that. But they are into a very heavy wind, and Ukraine being invaded by Russia doesn't help them.
Yeah, I'd say it just, you know, Hugh, I really do think that there's like what Mike Allen used to call in Playbook back in the day, mood music, which is that there are like all of these things are contributory to just a sour climate, right? I mean, I think that we could say that for sure. The Afghanistan withdrawal, the invasion of Ukraine by Russia. Mitch McConnell yesterday in Lexington, we had this in our midday edition, said he didn't think that Russia would have invaded Ukraine if the withdrawal from Afghanistan hadn't happened and wasn't botched. So all that being said, I think it's all contributory to just a sour climate. And we'll see if Biden could turn it around in some way or put a new face on it on Tuesday night, less than 1 week from today at his first State of the Union.
You know, I will be watching that with great interest. I'll be on with Brett Baer that night giving analysis of the State of the Union. The president faces the unenviable position of a scattered crowd. It will not be jam-packed in the House of Representatives, which I think many people are going to get a visual they have never seen before. Jake, tell me a little bit about yesterday's announcement by the president. He's done two speeches in 2 days. Neither of them overwhelming, both of them underwhelming, both of them widely criticized by Republicans. He's kind of in a catch-22. If he doesn't show up, his numbers go down. If he does show up, his numbers go down.
Well, I would say this. I mean, the administration, behind the scenes, and we've reported this as it happened, behind the scenes, the administration pushed Senate Democrats to resist any pre-invasion sanctions of Russia. That is something that Mitch McConnell and Senate Republicans vehemently disagreed with. And at the end of the day, that is the major factor that killed the sanctions package before Congress left about a week ago. So now Republicans say, and even some Democrats privately say, the administration is playing catch up in some regard, and that's difficult to do. But the administration felt as if, it's difficult to argue a counterfactual, but felt as if the sanctions would be more would have more bite if they came after Russian tanks rolled into Ukraine. And I don't know that. I mean, I'm not sure that the big thing is this, Hugh, and I think you know this, but the big kahuna is cutting Russia off from the financial system, kicking them out of the SWIFT banking system, which facilitates transactions around the country, around the world, rather. That would require international buy-in, and the administration has not done that yet.
You know, I actually don't think that is the big kahuna. I know that many people believe that SWIFT is the be-all and end-all, and I'd like to see it. I think it's individually named and expelled oligarchs. Britain did that with three oligarchs yesterday, and the House of Commons kind of exploded with quizzical wrath, saying, three? Really? We can't walk down the street without running into an oligarch in London. And by the way, I've had that happen to me. I just can't believe how many Russian limos and drivers are out smoking cigarettes while the boss is inside drinking vodka late into the evening. The oligarchs are everywhere. They've got to be thrown out of the West, and the president didn't do it, and Boris Johnson only did three, and Scott Morrison is saying we have a full-scale invasion in 24 hours. Clearly, the will threaten sanctions but not use them hasn't worked. Aren't they? Are they at all concerned that after Afghanistan, right before they give in to the Iranians, and they're about to collapse in front of the Iranians and give them sanctions relief, that they're never going to get the stink off of this year and a half, Jake?
Yeah, I think that they think that the, and again, this is their view, not mine, they believe that there's too much attention on what's going wrong, not enough attention in their estimation on what's gone right. They believe the infrastructure bill, the American Rescue Package, COVID is receding, which they'll take credit for. All of those things are good and are not getting enough attention. That's up for debate. And the question is, I mean, do all of these things, can they move past them? Can they move past the fact that the face of Europe is changing? Excuse me. Can they move past the fact that that Afghanistan, the withdrawal was kind of a mess? I don't know. I'm not sure how much those register on the radar of the American people when they go to vote. But again, I do think it contributes to an overall sour view of the world and how the world is going at the moment.
Jake, what do you think about the attempt to jump on President Trump's, at best, inartful statement, at worst, downright dumb statement about Putin? I think he was trying to do the George C. Scott in Patton moment, Rommel, you magnificent blank, I read your book, meaning to, you're an evil son of a gun, but we're just going to recognize that the malevolent genius at work here. And instead, Democrats are running up and down. And, of course, some of the cable channels are trying to. I just think they're crazy to try and make Trump the story when Putin's invading Russia. What do you think?
So I disagree with you respectfully. I actually don't. I mean, I don't know. I'm not a Trumpologist like many of my colleagues in the press are. But I do think that there is something to be said about. I mean, it was a ridiculous statement. I think it was a downright stupid statement. I think it was absurd, and I don't know how you explain that away. I guess that make what you're saying makes a modicum of sense, but I think he's saying, you know, that I just think it's a naive statement. That's that. I can't read the guy's mind. But, you know, I mean, listen, when things aren't going right for you, make the other guy the boogeyman. That's how it works. And in this case, in my estimation, he's a pretty easy and convenient boogeyman, and it reads true.
That's what they're trying very much, to make Trump the lead story as opposed to Russian aggression. And it's just not going to work, because everyone knows when the tanks start to fire and the rockets start to fall and the buildings start to be demolished. And it's like Israel fighting Hamas or Israel fighting Hezbollah. Very quickly, the story becomes, and the story is only who's dying. And so I just don't think it's very effective to try and make Trump into a Putin backer. He's not a Putin backer. He's calling him an evil genius. That's what I think he's doing. If he comes out and says, no, he's a real genius, then I'll have my problem with him and I'll articulate it. Jake, in terms of Emmer, when you were talking to him about the Republican prospects, they've got to be worried about confidence becoming too high, right? They've got to be worried that everyone's got this in the bag and they're going to get, like the Democrats thought they had 2020 in the bag and they lost 15 seats.
Yeah, Emmer, the NRCC chair, said he wishes the election were today. He says that independents and Republicans are lined up pretty evenly on what's important as compared to Democrats, who believe COVID and climate change are the two most important issues. That's in their internal polling. We asked him about, I thought this was interesting, maybe some people won't, we asked him about Trump and what his impact on the 2020 election is, and he basically said the president's a private citizen. He could do what he wants, but we're looking to November 2022, not November 2020, not the previous election, but the current election. That is something that I think is really is a really good insight into Emmer's mind. Emmer is a very rah-rah salesman type guy, and he has a big job. But here we are in February. It's not November. It's not even close to November. So they have to kind of, I compare it to golf, they've got to get around the course and kind of make as few bogeys as humanly possible to finish out this round, and that takes a lot of discipline and a lot of skill.
Even if your opponent is slicing the ball out of bounds with every swing, like Joe Biden is, you cannot get your mind off your own game, Jake. Great analogy. I agree with that analogy completely. Next week, more Jake Sherman from Punchbowl News. Go to punchbowlnews.com. Sign up. Get the free morning newsletter. Get the free special reports. And stay smart about what's going on in Capitol Hill. Coming right back, America. Stay tuned to the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show brought to you by Sierra Pacific Mortgage. For more info, call 888-888-1172.
Your son, you personally promised him you would be here.
Prayer is a powerful thing, Ethan. It really does work if you believe.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Trending now on the Eric Metaxas Show.
Was Sonia Sotomayor saying to them that there were 100,000 children in hospitals, many of them on ventilators? Eric, I went and looked up the data immediately. If you follow me on Instagram, you know that I've posted regularly the death rates of COVID positive people and heart disease and cancer. There are only 119,000 people hospitalized for COVID in the nation as we sat there that day. So you're saying 100,000 of them were children when the data shows that only 5 children are hospitalized out of every 100,000 hospitalizations. There were maybe 6 kids in the hospital, none of them on ventilators that I could find.
100,000. Who's counting? Hey, we're all about grace, bro.
And it's a whole consistent pattern, Eric, that they used to do kind of in the shade. They would make more implications than direct statements. They wouldn't campaign on things that were factually false. The left has lost its rooting, its mooring,
how many people do we know in the evangelical church who do not give a damn about this? They absolutely don't seem to understand that when leaders lie, when they do these kinds of things, it hurts people. It usually hurts poor people the most, and we have many in the evangelical church who have absolutely turned a blind eye. Again, this rises to levels unprecedented in American life. I mean, it's one thing to say we have differences. This is a level of political theater, of lying and grandstanding that is so pernicious to the fabric of the republic.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe today at rumble.com.
Tesla was a genius. His most amazing discoveries thought to be written in a lost journal. Now in the right hands, it could revolutionize the 21st century, but in the wrong hands.
Kill him. Jump.
If you can stop an earthquake, doesn't that mean you could start one too?
That's why that notebook should never fall into the wrong hands.
There's an old brown battered notebook in my office at work. You have to find it, take it, and keep it hidden at all costs. The G20 leaders meeting downtown, they're in danger. In fact, the whole of downtown could be in danger.
If we are to build a superhuman, we must first eliminate those who are flawed.
People are created equally. All of downtown, the high-rises were built on rollers to withstand horizontal shakes. A vertical quake this size could collapse half of downtown.
We have commenced a countdown.
Shall we stop this thing?
Save the universe!
How 1 million children
were placed with local foster families. Parents from all walks of life share their stories of overcoming the one-child policy by taking in orphans.
Go to salemnow.com.
Welcome back, America. What does Donald Trump think of Putin? Let's go back to the July 2018 NATO summit, cut number 28.
Well, I have to say, I think it's very sad when Germany makes a massive oil and gas deal with Russia, where you're supposed to be guarding against Russia, and Germany goes out and pays billions and billions of dollars a year to Russia. So we're protecting Germany, we're protecting France, we're protecting all of these countries. And then numerous of the countries go out and make a pipeline deal with Russia, where they're paying billions of dollars into the coffers of Russia. So we're supposed to protect you against Russia, but they're paying billions of dollars to Russia. And I think that's very inappropriate. And the former chancellor of Germany is the head of the pipeline company that's supplying the gas. Ultimately, Germany will have almost 70% of their country controlled by Russia with natural gas. So you tell me, is that appropriate? I mean, I've been complaining about this from the time I got in. It should have never been allowed to have happened. But Germany is totally controlled by Russia because they will be getting from 60 to 70% of their energy from Russia and a new pipeline. And you tell me if that's appropriate, because I think it's not. And I think it's a very bad thing for NATO, and I don't think it should have happened. Now, if you look at it, Germany is a captive of Russia because they supply. They got rid of their coal plants. They got rid of their nuclear. They're getting so much of the oil and gas from Russia. I think it's something that NATO has to look at. I think it's very inappropriate. You and I agree that it's inappropriate.
Now, let's talk about what Joe Biden thinks of Putin. From a 2001 Senate committee hearing with then Secretary of State Colin Powell, cut number 29.
I'm close to amazed by how far Putin seems to have come in making throwing his lot with the West. He seems to have, from all the briefings I've gotten, actually stiff-armed his military here and stiff-armed some of the Browns and Reds in his government. And out of government, and made a very, I don't think anybody since Peter the Great has made such a significant, at least initial move to the West.
Okay, so President Trump was right in 2018. Joe Biden was wrong in 2001, and they're both off key yesterday. And so I don't really care what former presidents say. He can defend himself. I don't think it's smart to be saying anything good about Putin or anything that can be perceived as good, even though the former president does not perceive him as other than malign. Nevertheless, he said it. He's got to explain it. He's just got to learn to stay on message. You can't say, Rommel, you magnificent blank, unless you're actually George C. Scott and you get five takes. Now, let me tell you about andrewandtodd.com. Whether I'm here or not, every single day, on the weekend or when I'm off, when I'm in Florida, wherever I am, AndrewandTodd.com are open and handling your needs. They are a great sponsor because they handle the needs of everyone who need to refinance their home right now before these interest rates continue to climb to the stratosphere. And if you're buying a home, you need to get to them right now. If you need a realtor, they will find you a realtor. If you need an investment advisor because you want to take money out at a low rate and put it in a very secure and stable interest-bearing account that will try and keep up with inflation, but you're afraid that when you take the money out, when your kid go to college in 3 years, interest rates are going to be 8, 9, 10%. You're right to be aware of that. That's why you need to go to andrewandtodd.com today. Andrewandtodd.com. 888-1172. 888-1172. no matter what the market is doing, we know that the interest rates are marching north. Even if Russia triggers a massive sell-off, even if there's a massive rebound because Russia doesn't trigger a massive, it doesn't matter. What matters is that we printed $4 trillion of money we ought not to have spent in January and February. We spent it, and now the inflationary bubble is going to move through the snake of the American economy and make it impossible for people to buy a house. Don't get caught in that. Go now to andrewandtodd.com or call them at 888-1172. 888-1172. Can we hear that Peter the Great thing again? Cut 29.
I'm close to amazed by how far Putin seems to have come in making throwing his lot with the West. He seems to have, from all the briefings I've gotten, actually stiff-armed his military here and stiff-armed some of the Browns and Reds in his government and out of government, and made a very, I don't think anybody since Peter the Great has made such a significant, at least initial move.
Wow. Stay tuned.
Trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
You want to know what's even crazier and funnier in a sick way? There's a security guard right there. The shoplifter, the looter, walks right by the security guard who isn't doing anything. He's got a jacket on with the big security on the back of his coat. And he stands there and watches the guy. The guy literally brushes right by the security guard. The security guard, what are they paying the security guard for? Just to stand there? Why don't we just put mannequins up in stores in New York? I may never go back. I swear, I may never go back. New York is turning into a hellhole. And Democrats are watching it. They're letting it happen. I can't wait to get Joe Borelli's take on all of this insanity.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
You called your son and you personally promised him you would be here.
Lucas, I don't know how to help you.
Your daddy loves you, you gotta know it, pal. Do you
feel the love? Prayer is a powerful thing, Ethan. It really does work, if you believe.
What reason does he have to care about some guy who's supposed to be his dad, but he's never around?
I can't do it. I can't. I'm not ready for this, man.
I'm done with you.
We all deserve a second chance, right, Ethan?
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
This is Carol Platt-Lebow for townhall.com. Sometimes there are policies so destructive that at first you don't believe they're true. Joe Biden is currently defending one, his plan to award $450,000 to migrants separated from their families after entering the U.S. illegally. Children of deceased U.S. soldiers are separated from their parents permanently. They don't receive this kind of money. And migrants who enter the U.S. legally certainly don't get this kind of payout. The really big jackpot, it seems, is being reserved for the lawbreakers. There are some obvious truths here. First, behavior that's subsidized gets repeated. Joe Biden is effectively inviting many more illegal immigrants to breach America's open borders. Second, he's betting over time the payoffs will benefit his party in political terms. Meanwhile, the vast majority of Americans watch in shock and dismay as our president, the country's chief law enforcement officer, brazenly rewards lawbreaking, a clear violation of his oath to defend our nation's laws. It's a sorry sight indeed.
Trending now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
The Democratic Party somehow has convinced black people that they're the good guys, never mind the skanky history of the Democratic Party. That was a party of slavery. There is a whole big cottage industry for racism. If racism went away, a lot of people would be unemployed.
The mob during the Minneapolis riots following the death of George Floyd, a bunch of white thugs, frankly, burning down the city's traditional black and Asian business district.
They're racist, racist, racist. Everything's racist.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com. Streaming on Salem Now.
This is a story of how a million children were placed with local foster family.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
will do everything in his power to use the Iran issue in order to further weaken our response in Ukraine.
Now, Congressman, I'm going to talk with HR McMaster later in the show about his book Battlegrounds, in which he discusses strategic narcissism and how the United States has been self-absorbed and projecting its own values and reactions onto our adversaries and enemies for a long time. If we strike a deal with Iran right now, that will be peak strategic narcissism. I mean, peak, absolute peak. I want to play for you a 2018 statement by Donald Trump. Now, yesterday, President Trump did himself no favors by being ambiguous about the malign nature of Putin. I know he believes that. I know that. I've talked to him about it. But his statement yesterday made it sound like he admires Putin. I think he was trying to be the admiring Putin the way that George C. Scott playing Patton admired Rommel, you magnificent blank. I read your book. Here's President Trump when he's president in July of 2018 at the NATO summit, cut 28.
Well, I have to say, I think it's very sad when Germany makes a massive oil and gas deal with Russia where you're supposed to be guarding against Russia and Germany goes out and pays billions and billions of dollars a year to Russia. So we're protecting Germany, we're protecting France, we're protecting all of these countries. And then numerous of the countries go out and make a pipeline deal with Russia where they're paying billions of dollars into the coffers of Russia. So we're supposed to protect you against Russia, but they're paying billions of dollars to Russia. And I think that's very inappropriate. And the former chancellor of Germany is the head of the pipeline company that's supplying the gas. Ultimately, Germany will have almost 70% of their country controlled by Russia with natural gas. So you tell me, is that appropriate? I mean, I've been complaining about this from the time I got in. It should have never been allowed to have happened. But Germany is totally controlled by Russia because they will be getting from 60 to 70% of their energy from Russia and a new pipeline. And you tell me if that's appropriate, because I think it's not. And I think it's a very bad thing for NATO, and I don't think it should have happened. Now, if you look at it, Germany is a captive of Russia because they supply. They got rid of their coal plants. They got rid of their nuclear. They're getting so much of the oil and gas from Russia. I think it's something that NATO has to look at. I think it's very inappropriate. You and I agree that it's inappropriate.
Now, Mike Gallagher, Congressman, so he was right in 2018. He shot himself in his foot yesterday. Was he right in 2018?
100% right. And the Trump administration's energy policy put us in a dramatically better position to push back against Putin, Iran, and China. And the fact that the Biden administration, starting in week one with the cancellation of the Keystone Pipeline, as well as restrictions on domestic oil exploration and development, has shot our entire country in the foot. And the fact that Biden and Kamala Harris went out there and said, well, Americans need to be prepared to suffer more financial pain because energy prices are going to increase with this conflict in Ukraine. Well, I'm sorry, I don't think working class Americans should have to suffer the financial consequences of Biden's foolish decisions when it comes to American energy policy. It's absolutely absurd, and it's weakening our geopolitical hand internationally. It's taking tools out of our kit that we could be playing in a crisis precisely at this moment. It makes absolutely no sense. I don't understand it. And again, Hugh, I just think we're going to see a scenario soon where part of the administration's justification for an Iran deal that will make the 2015 Iran deal looked good in comparison. It'll be the new worst deal in history. Will be that by bringing more Iranian crude onto the market, you're going to reduce prices overall, which will be absolutely absurd. With the possible exception of the Democrats' radical policy of infusing diversity, equity, and inclusion and identity politics into every aspect of the federal government and American education, or continued support for masking kids and shutting down schools. I don't know if there's a bigger blunder. Well, and Afghanistan is in that list. If there's a bigger blunder than their misguided energy policy, it makes absolutely no sense. And former President Trump was right when he called that out in 2018.
Now, if I can summarize the Democratic platform, and I try to be objective, inflation at home, appeasement abroad, teachers unions first, students last, an open southern border, and closed police precincts. I think that fairly sums it up, the substance, Congressman. Am I being fair?
You're being absolutely fair.
And so the question becomes, how do you spin capitulation in Afghanistan and Ukraine? Because this is capitulation. He has not sanctioned anyone before they do anything. I don't understand it. You can't deter someone if they don't know what you're going to do. It doesn't work that way. Because if you base future performance based on past performance, you know, it's no guarantee, but it's likely it's going to be a weak and tepid set of sanctions because he hasn't announced it.
And here is where I think General McMaster's argument about strategic narcissism is so important. Yesterday, President Biden said, you know, who in Lord's name does Putin think gives him the right to declare new countries, right? That's mere imaging our value structure onto a Russian thug.
Onto Europe. Onto Europe over 500 years.
What gives him the right is that he has the might and the will to use hard power, and we don't. And we think Putin's going to be deterred by getting disinvited from Davos or a sternly worded statement that comes out of Foggy Bottom. That's just not the way the world works. I wish it did work that way. It'd be a far more peaceful world, but it is an anarchic and competitive world that we must deal with as it is.
In which there are evil and malevolent actors. I want to close on that so no one can misinterpret it. You understand, I understand, the audience. There are evil and malevolent people who are gifted with cunning and a killer's instinct. I think Putin is along with Xi and Khamenei, the evil big three.
I completely agree, Hugh. Just remind General McMaster that though he may be a smart geopolitical analyst, his sports allegiances are even worse than yours. He's an Eagles fan, a Phillies fan, Hugh. It really undermines a lot of his broader...
Well, that's absolutely true. I was unaware of that, so he doesn't know anything about football. But I will bring that up to him, and I'll tell him that on the Intel Committee, we actually have it as a matter of fact that the Eagles are horrible. Thank you, Congressman Gallagher. Good to talk. I didn't know that, but it's good to find that out in time. Let me remind everyone, even when I'm not here, the interest rate clock is ticking, and andrewandtodd.com need your attention soon. They need you to get there and to buy their products and use their products because you need to refinance now before those interest rates go away. Andrewandtodd.com are there to help you, but you got to call them, 888-1172. You also have to use relieffactor.com. Even when I'm not here, I'm taking it. Even when I'm in Florida, I'm taking it. Every day I'm taking it. When you don't hear me on the phone, I'm taking it. Why? Because I don't have my meeting until tomorrow night, but I've got to fly today to make sure I get there. So I'll have tomorrow morning to run on the boardwalks of Florida, which I hope are as fine and beautiful as the boardwalks of California. We'll see. I'll be trundling along because I got my relieffactor.com with me, and I'm hoping you decide today to join the legions of people, tens of thousands of people who take it every single morning. Before you get in the car to go to work, before you do anything, before you actually begin your first cup of coffee, grab some lukewarm coffee, grab some water, whatever it is, take your four pills in the relieffactor.com packet and feel better about the day ahead because you're protected against the minor aches and pains that make those days so unfortunate. Wesbury hopefully joins us to talk about the effect of Russia's invasion on markets when we return.
Streaming on Salem Now.
You called your son, and you personally promised him you would be here.
Lucas, I don't know how to help you.
Your daddy loves you. You gotta know it, pal. Do you feel
the love? Prayer is a powerful thing, Ethan. It really does work. If you believe.
What reason does he have to care about some guy who's supposed to be his dad, but he's never around?
I can't do it. I can't. I'm not ready for this, man.
I'm done with you.
We all deserve a second chance, right, Ethan?
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
This is Carol Platt-Lebow for townhall.com. Sometimes there are policies so destructive that at first you don't believe they're true. Joe Biden is currently defending one, his plan to award $450,000 to migrants separated from their families after entering the U.S. illegally. Children of deceased U.S. soldiers are separated from their parents permanently. They don't receive this kind of money. And migrants who enter the U.S. legally certainly don't get this kind of payout. The really big jackpot, it seems, is being reserved for the lawbreakers. There are some obvious truths here. First, behavior that's subsidized gets repeated. Joe Biden is effectively inviting many more illegal immigrants to breach America's open borders. Second, he's betting over time the payoffs will benefit his party in political terms. Meanwhile, the vast majority of Americans watch in shock and dismay as our president, the country's chief law enforcement officer, brazenly rewards lawbreaking, a clear violation of his oath to defend our nation's laws. It's a sorry sight indeed.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Welcome back, America. Brian Wesbury is Chief Investment Analyst and Economist at First Trust Portfolio. He is also our friend out on the road. Follow him on Twitter at Wesbury. Brian, good morning. How are you?
Excellent, Hugh. I am excellent. I'm in East Coast time today.
It's a normal time to be talking to me. My question is, I'm looking at the overseas markets this morning, and they're all up. England, Germany, France. Price of oil is hanging around $95 a barrel. And the question is, has the market priced in a Ukraine disaster, or does the market just desperately hope it doesn't get worse?
I think the market has kind of decided that, okay, this is happening, but it's not happening with a blitzkrieg or a shock and awe. So, you know, it will, peaceful is the wrong word to use because people are dying, but it's not an all-out war with Ukraine, and I think for the market that's pretty important.
Now, Australia's Prime Minister Scott Morrison is a smart guy, Brian Wesbury, and he leaned in this morning and said full-on invasion within 24 hours. When that happens, what does our market do? I think this is a head fake rally.
Yeah, I think we have priced a lot of this in. I mean, if you think about what's gone on this year, we all know that Build Back Better, you know, look, I'm not a Keynesian. I don't think all that government spending was going to do anything for the economy. It might have provided a little artificial boost for a while, but everybody knows now that things failed. Deficits are going to be smaller this year. Everyone knows that the Fed is going to raise interest rates. We don't know how many. But now they tell us it's not going to be 50 basis two rate hikes all at once. And then finally, Ukraine is kind of underway and the world has sort of accepted it. So I think the market, you know, it's a forward looking mechanism. It tries to price in, okay, what are the dangers? What are the unexpected things that we don't know and how will they affect profits? And I think what the market has decided is, okay, none of these things are great, but profits will still be up in 2022. And inflation is going to help profits in certain areas, in commodities, you know, materials companies that make aluminum, that make steel, that get gold out of the ground, that grow corn. You know, those kinds of companies are going to do well this year. So I think we might be through the hard part, because now the market expects and has fully priced in all of these events.
Now, the Kremlin, this is the headline from the Washington Post at this hour, Kremlin warns Americans will face financial consequences of U.S. sanctions. Meanwhile, our government is warning our businesses to prepare for possible cyber attacks. This has got to make investors jittery, Brian Wesbury.
Yeah, it does. You know, I think, you know, Hugh, I've put a little bit of thought into this. I, you know, probably need to put a lot more. But I think in our world today, the cyber attack, the true all-out cyber attack, is the second worst thing. I mean, I don't want to, you know, guns and bombs and artillery shells are really bad. Don't hear me wrong there. But kind of the second worst thing that can happen next to nuclear war. Because I believe, now I'm not a CIA officer, I'm not inside, but I believe that we could turn off the power in Russia. I think we, and I think they would spend 2 weeks getting it back on, and the minute they did, we'd shut it down again if we really wanted to. And this could be devastating, kill lots of people in the middle of a war. And so I don't think the world wants to go in that direction, but it certainly shows us that there's a powerful force out there that's, you know, not quite nuclear war, but gosh, in the middle of winter in Russia, no power is a really bad thing. Same thing in the United States. So, you know, I hope we don't go there. And I think that's the one place that could really spook the market if a full-blown cyber war got started.
Now, I'm going to talk with General McMaster about that, because he writes a lot about it in his new book, Battleground. What would you look for as the first sign, Brian? We got a minute. What would worry you the most, a part of the grid going down or a business announcing that they're offline?
Yeah, the grid going down, that's the number one thing. I mean, if you did that up in the, you know, in the Northeast or the you know, where I live, where I'm moving away from, Illinois, Minnesota, Wisconsin, North Dakota, South Dakota, that's deadly to lose your electricity. So, you know, that's what I would worry about the most. You know, and this idea, by the way, that the White House can fix our supply, can fix energy prices, my line is they can't even make a pencil. How are they ever going to fix a supply chain as complicated as energy?
They have that's just a joke. They have no idea. That's going to be self-correcting or not corrected at all, because you can't command and control the L.A. port, much less the entire American distribution system. Wesbury on Twitter, Wesbury. Brian, thank you. I'm coming back next hour. General McMaster and I set this up a long time ago, but boy, talk about great timing, plus Senator Tom Cotton to lead off the hour. All the latest updates from Ukraine. Stay with us, America.
Trending now on the Eric Metaxas Show.
When you had the president in Atlanta saying to the crowd there that, you know, he didn't march in the shoes of the students that are marching today, but that he marched in the civil rights movement, and he remembers the first time he got arrested, when he never marched in any civil rights movement and has never been arrested.
I mean, can we even believe this? That he routinely says things that everyone knows are made up. Nobody calls him on it. Look, this is why you do your program, I do my program. We need to do our best to get the truth out. And we have to be clear the president, he's plumb loco. I don't know what is going on. I guess I would say this. I'll bet that within his administration, there is very nasty fighting because they see what we see. I'm sure Kamala Harris despises the Biden gang, and the Biden gang despises her. They have to keep that quiet. But it's really something that I think they're going to consume their own.
The Democratic Party knows that they're in trouble. When you say that their staff sees what's going on and we all see it, we got to remember one other thing. Vladimir Putin, Premier Xi, the leader of North Korea, the leader of Iran, these people all see it too. And there is a message being sent globally that America is a laughingstock right now, that the bowl of mashed potatoes that serves as the president in the White House right now is nothing more than a suit.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe today at Rumble.com. Trending now on the Larry Elder Show.
Could you let that happen for 10 weeks of your children being kept in a box in the library, excluded, put on display, and so on and so forth for that long? I kind of feel like, and I can tell you are a very caring mom, which is why you're bringing this public, but I kind of feel like that would happen for 2 hours, and I would be down there at that school and pulling my kid out, much less 2 to 10 weeks. Did they really endure that for that long?
They really did that for that long, and I really appreciate that question, and I've gotten that question a lot, and how we looked at it as a family is we could pull them and just go about our lives, and they'll just do this to someone else, or we could stay and fight and hold our ground. And my kids didn't want to leave that school. They've been in that school, my son, since first grade to eighth grade. They had their friends there. We still had hope that the trusted adults would do the right thing. And we eventually have pulled them to homeschool. But during those weeks, we were fighting. We have hundreds of emails to the administration, the Dallas ISD school board. We went down and I brought 30 or 40 grandmas and grandpas and other parents from other schools down to fight and speak on our behalf. Parents even scheduled protests, 3 protests outside the school. So we were fighting, but I think at this point in our country, the war has come into the family, and our kids can no longer be shielded from it. They needed to be guided through it, which we did as a family, to build a backbone and learn how to stand up and fight, because this is their next generation. So instead of shielding them from it, we help them move through it with grace, integrity, and dignity, and they came out stronger.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
You called your son, and you personally promised him you would be here.
Prayer is a powerful thing, Ethan. It really does work, if you believe.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
This is Hugh Hewitt for townhall.com. Buckle up for 2022. The year in politics is going to be rough. The midterm election year seems predestined to banish the Democratic majorities in both houses of Congress. The country senses infirmity in President Biden, and many worry that our adversaries in China, Russia, and Iran sense that opening too. The shadow campaign for the GOP nomination in 2024 opens now, with a clear frontrunner being former President Donald Trump. The ranks of the top tier among possible GOP presidential nominees in alphabetical order starts with 2 senators, Arkansas's Tom Cotton and Ted Cruz of Texas. Then we have the populist Florida Governor Ron DeSantis, the former Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, and South Carolina Senator Tim Scott. If the world grows even darker in the days to come, Cotton and Pompeo, 2 former soldiers, start with some advantages. It's possible one or more will run whether or not the former president does. My bet, with 3 years to go, is that Trump runs, and runs hard. Buckle up. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
publicpolicy.pepperdine.edu. Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
Look at you! Ow! Hey, look at that! I wasn't ready for that.
And there goes Peter Dinklage beating the crap out of Will Ferrell for calling him an angry elf.
Call me a
I mean, listen, he's certainly not an elf, but he's an angry guy. You know, I hate to put everything in a political perspective here, but isn't it true? And I assume Peter Dinklage is no conservative. He's woke. He wants to cancel Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. Why do they always want to cancel everything? You know, they want to cancel everything. What do conservatives believe in? We are for things. Biden's always saying, "What are Republicans for? Not for anything." Yes, we're for everything. We're for people. We're for people's right to make decisions about their health. We're for movies. We're for different views on the airwaves. We're not for people being canceled or movies being canceled or things being canceled. We're for things. And your side, Biden, is against everything. You're against Snow White and the Seven Dwarves. Oh, I mean, Disney obviously taking it seriously because they're redoing the whole movie, I guess. Do you portray them as children? Should child actors play the Seven Dwarves? You're going to get little Billy or Susie, who's about 9? The Seven Dwarves in Snow White aren't children. Grumpy isn't a kid. I mean, in fact, that would be a great, if they're casting people, maybe Peter Dinklage can play Grumpy. Because he fit right in.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
As Galileans, we witnessed his first miracle. He warned us that a time of great deception would come. But we must hold on to our faith that one day he would return to save us from the end of the world.
What if there was evidence that proves that this is all real?
Because there were so many people bringing up little bits and pieces of this. I'm thinking, there's got to be a pattern here. This discovery proves that he is coming back.
This is the most profound discovery in human history.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Morning, glory, America. Bonjour, hi, Canada. Coming up at the bottom of the hour, Lieutenant General HR McMaster, former National Security Advisor to President Trump, joins me. His new book, Battleground, opens eerily with a review of the 2014 Russian invasion of Ukraine and the Russian new generation warfare tactics that are again on display. I begin this hour, though, with United States Senator Tom Cotton, who serves on Senate Intel, Senate Armed Services, Senate Judiciary. Good morning, Senator.
Good morning, Hugh. It's good to be on with you.
I played your commentary to John Roberts. Anything different this morning that you've been able to discover other than Scott Morrison in Australia, the Prime Minister, saying the full-scale invasion within 24 hours?
No, Hugh, I haven't seen any new developments in Ukraine or in Russia beyond what Vladimir Putin said to his own people a couple nights ago and what President Biden said yesterday, which is a welcome step. But as I said yesterday, not even a half measure, probably a quarter measure of what we should be doing, what we should have been doing for a long time. I hope that President Biden will stiffen his spine and start announcing more and tougher sanctions very soon.
You know, I don't know what Vladimir Putin learned at KGB, OCS, whatever the equivalent is, but I'm sure they taught him Lenin's aphorism that when you have a bayonet, proceed as long as you run into mush and stop when you hit steel. Has he even remotely found any steel yet anywhere?
I don't think that we've shown Vladimir Putin steel over the last 4 or 5 months. The officials at the highest level of the United States government has known that this was happening before Halloween. That's how long this troop buildup has been occurring. And it became public, I think, in the Christmas season. And we've consistently conciliated and declined to take steps that might have deterred Vladimir Putin. Of course, we had a vote in the Senate last month to impose harsh sanctions on Russia, and the Democrats stopped it. Shockingly, they used the racist relic of the Jim Crow era, as they called the filibuster, to stop those sanctions against Russia. And they did it at the behest of the Biden White House, Hugh. These are Democrats in the Senate who had voted repeatedly for sanctions against Russia in the past, but the Biden White House furiously lobbied them against it. All of that has just projected weakness and appeasement towards Vladimir Putin. And I think that he viewed the time is right to take what he's always wanted, which is to take back Ukraine into the fold of greater Russia. This is not about NATO. It's not about military exercises. Vladimir Putin knows as well as anyone that Ukraine was not on the verge of joining NATO. There was not some big deadline coming up. We don't conduct military exercises in Ukraine. This is, as you saw Vladimir Putin saying on Russian television a couple nights ago, about correcting what he views as massive historic crimes, depriving the greater Russian Empire of Ukraine, which has been part of it at least since the reign of Catherine the Great, if not beforehand, in his mind.
No, I think he's a sociopath, and I think Putin has really lost any sense of restraint. But tyrants do have to fear the people below him, which is why I do not understand how the oligarchs are still in the West. Yesterday, Great Britain threw three of them out. There got to be 300. Congressman Gallagher told us about the Navalny 25. Shouldn't we start naming names and seizing condos, yachts, and mistresses, jewelry, and throwing people out of the West?
We should, Hugh. And again, that's a step that's long overdue. It's a step that actually requires more cooperation from our European allies, because there's a much larger presence of Russian oligarchs and their money in Europe than there is in the United States. It's hard for most Americans to appreciate the vast scale of wealth that these Russian oligarchs possess. I mean, this is wealth on the scale of the czars. Now, a lot of our European partners might hesitate to do that because it's created an effective Russia lobby in the capitals of Europe. Not just the oligarchs, it's their bankers and their lawyers and their consultants and their realtors and their home decorators and their yacht service companies and their property management companies and the ski resort towns where they all vacation, and the luxury retail stores in the French Riviera where their mistresses go shop, and the private schools where their kids go. All that should end, though. They should all be expelled, and they should all be sent back to Russia where Vladimir Putin can deal with them and their discontented mistresses.
The Telegraph is reporting this morning that Russia's ultra-wealthy oligarchs have lost $32 billion so far this year, and looming sanctions mean even more of their wealth could be wiped out. The country's 23 billionaires currently have a net worth of $343 billion. And so the market, they're just talking about the market. They're not talking about anything that we have done about ejecting people. But does the United States have the authority? Does President Biden have the authority to eject and seize Russians and Russian assets?
For the most part, Hugh. For the most part, he's had the authority to take any action that Democrats in Congress have proposed for the last month. What we've tried to do is to give greater authorities or to require steps to be taken to impose so-called mandatory sanctions, sanctions that must be imposed. The president doesn't have the discretion to waive, but he has substantial existing authority to take many more steps than he announced yesterday, and I think that's necessary.
Now, Senator Cotton, put your airborne hat on again, back to your combat days. I don't think the Ukrainians are going to roll over. I don't think the Russians are the Germans in 1939. I think they're going to run into a lot of resistance. What do you think, and what do you think about the arms that we've gotten to Ukraine over 4 years?
Well, Hugh, if it was just a ground-to-ground fight, you may be right, but I think you have to remember that Russia vastly overmatches Ukraine in both missiles and air force. So what I worry is that if Russia goes for the jugular, the first 12 to 24 hours, we'll see a massive blitz of missile strikes on Ukraine's command and control structures and critical infrastructure, as well as strategic airstrikes. So much so that Ukraine's command and control of those ground forces could disintegrate in just a matter of a few days, if not a few hours. And that would leave those ground forces, which again, might be able to fight for some time, largely in the dark. I think that's probably what Russia's strategy is. If you look at the kinds of forces they've built up on all four sides of Ukraine.
Now, Senator, you remember Shock and Awe, of course, as well as I do, because you were, I don't know if you were in the Army in 2003, but you were close to it. Shock and Awe didn't actually shock and awe Iraq to the extent that we thought, and their leader escaped and hid, and the resistance began. Is that what you anticipate in Ukraine as well?
Hugh, I think that we should support a government in exile if it comes to that point. It's not clear from the forces that Vladimir Putin has positioned around Russia if he intends to seize all of Ukrainian territory. Western Ukraine is very different from the rest of the country in a couple of regards, Hugh. It's much more anti-Russian because it's really never been part of the Russian Empire except for the Soviet era. But for all of history before that, it was largely oriented towards the West under the Habsburg Empire. And second, the terrain is just very different in Western Ukraine, much harder for Russian armor to roll through there the way it does the relatively flat plains of the rest of the country. So there may be, even if Vladimir Putin invades, goes to Kiev, there may still be Ukrainian territory that is beyond his control. But if he does seize all of Ukraine, then we need to support a Ukrainian government in exile somewhere in Europe, safely out of the reach of Russia, just like we did the governments in exile, for example, Poland's government in World War II, which remained in London.
Now, Senator, it hasn't come up yet, but what Putin did in Chechnya were war crimes. If he does in Kyiv what he did in Chechnya, they'll be guilty of war crimes. Has anyone been talking? I mean, if they indiscriminately bomb civilians, those are war crimes. And do we expect that to be demarcated as such, articulated by the White House and pressed at The Hague?
Well, it should be. If Vladimir Putin and the Russian military commits war crimes, they should be held to account. And Hugh, I would note that it's not only indiscriminate bombings of civilians that may happen. You've probably seen the reports of lists drawn up to capture or to kill various Ukrainian officials or dissidents or activists in Ukraine. That could happen on a large scale view, so much so that Russia is running concentration camps in Ukraine as well. And again, that's something that the West and the civilized world needs to highlight and needs to hold Russia to account for if it comes to pass.
Last question, Senator. Is he more, Putin, more in the evil genius camp or in the off his rocker camp? Because after that speech 2 days ago, I thought off the rocker camp. What do you think?
Well, Hugh, I want to point out that speech is nothing new. This is not something that Vladimir Putin just announced. That speech is basically just a lightly edited version of a long essay he published last summer that made all the same points on what he calls the historical unity of the Russians and the Ukrainians. So even if you view his account of history as crazy and revisionist, you shouldn't lose sight of the fact that it's something that he's held for 20 years, so no one should be surprised by the actions he's taking.
Senator Tom Cotton, thank you. Stay on TV talking. Maybe someone at the White House will listen to you. I hope they do. Coming right back, America. Stay tuned to the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show brought to you by Sierra Pacific Mortgage. For more info, call 888-888-1172.
Organs of the state are not merely corrupt, but that they've been weaponized to go after perceived domestic enemies. And that's very scary.
Our constitutional democracy enshrines the peaceful transfer of power.
We are now all rooting for his success. The peaceful transition of power is one of the hallmarks of our democracy.
We don't live in the United States of America as any of us would like to understand it.
We have a peaceful transition of power process. That's not what happened.
They interviewed General Flynn, and they did it in what was a complete ambush.
I thought it's early enough. Let's just send a couple guys over.
And the audience was, ha, 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 ha. How funny to set up an innocent man.
This is what third world security states do.
They spy on their political opponents like this.
This is part of a concerted Russian influence operation.
Russian interference.
They colluded. They were in on it.
He would constantly say, I have seen evidence of collusion.
Until this is released, I can't comment.
I can't go into the particulars.
Russians, I'm not going to be specific.
He knew he could just say it on TV and then hide behind, well, it's all classified, I can't get into it.
Well, it's classified, you can't see it.
Collusion, you just got to be willing to see it.
New York's Daily News ran this front page, Trump is Hitler.
How could 62 million Americans vote for Hitler? Are 62 million Americans Nazis?
We really almost thought it was a joke. Like, really, you're not going to accept that you lost this election?
Then they see the Russia collusion narrative sitting right there in front of them and say, why don't we just say that he cheated?
It divided the country in ways that people can't imagine. It's inspired massive violence. It's given people who are bad faith actors a license to do whatever they want because they literally feel like they're fighting Russian spies and Nazis.
Russiagate has been the most egregious abuse of everything that was supposed to have been good about our government.
The thing that they were investigating the Trump campaign for is what they themselves were doing.
Schools are lining up to push the transgender agenda on kids and cut parents out of the equation.
Go to salemnow.com.
How 1 million children were placed with local foster families. Parents from all walks of life share their stories of overcoming the one-child policy by taking in orphans.
Go to salemnow.com.
I grew up poor, which is even worse than being poor.
We would have sandwiches with no meat.
My American dream entailed working hard and making $20,000 a year. But I surpassed that goal and became a corporate CEO.
We'll all be able to say, free at last! Free at last!
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
The Democratic Party somehow has convinced black people that they're the good guys, never mind the skanky history of the Democratic Party. That was a party of slavery.
There is a whole big cottage industry for racism. If racism went away, a lot of people would be unemployed.
The mob during the Minneapolis riots following the death of George Floyd, a bunch of white thugs, frankly, burning down the city's traditional black and Asian business district.
They're racist, racist, racist. Everything's racist.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. The invasion has begun, but it's still in the Donbas, not yet beyond the Donbas. So the partial invasion rhetoric being used by some on the left is simply ridiculous. An invasion is underway, and Ukrainian Foreign Minister Kuleba said as much yesterday. Cut number 12.
First, there is no such thing as minor, middle, or major invasion. Invasion is an invasion. Second, as I said earlier, we do appreciate the sanctions which were announced today. They target Russia. They're very specific. They are painful. I can say frankly that yesterday when we learned about the first executive order to impose sanctions on related to economic activities in the Donetsk, with Donetsk and Lugansk, we were puzzled because we saw how the site that thought recognition from Russia is being punished, but we didn't see how Russia, who granted its recognition, is punished. But we saw it today. And this strategy of imposing sanctions by waves, if I may put it this way, is something that that can work if it continues in a very sustainable way. President Putin should not have...
That is the key. If it continues in a sustainable way, that means more today and more tomorrow. I'm going to be in Florida tomorrow, but I hope Ed Morrissey brings you word that we have begun the ejection of oligarchs from the Navalny list and everybody else. Out, out, out. I'll talk with General HR McMaster after the break about that. Let me do a little business. Two sponsors. First, let me remind you, andrewandtodd.com. Whether I'm here, whether Ed Morrissey is here, whether somebody is here, every single day they are there at 888-1172 at andrewandtodd.com. And what they are doing every day is taking care of your lending needs for real estate, residential real estate. Are you buying a house? Are you refinancing a house? Are you adding on to a house? Or are you using your house as your bank because it's gone up so much in value over the last 5 years and the COVID hike in house prices? If you're trying to get that money out, look, the interest rate goes up every single day, a little tiny bit. And you missed maybe $50 a month in savings by waiting a week, but you don't have to stay seated forever. You can get off your rear end and call 888-1172 or go to andrewandtodd.com and tell them what you need. Yeah, answer a few questions online, they will get back to you. They have a crackerjack team. I've known Andrew Del Rey for 20 plus years. Todd Avakian sent me my birthday note this week and celebrating our friendship and how greatly this audience has benefited from their efforts on your behalf. Don't forget them and don't kill yourself for missing the bottom. You did miss the bottom. It's behind us. But we're so far from the top, you'd better start going now. AndrewandTodd.com. Also, don't forget, ReliefFactor.com. ReliefFactor.com. Whether I'm here on a plane to Florida, whether I'm coming back from Florida, whether it's Ed Morrissey or Kurt Schlichter or whoever's here, they always tell you about our great sponsor, ReliefFactor.com, because tens of thousands of you just need me. You know, the average time spent listening, about 30 minutes. Some of you are three-hour listeners. That's great. Most of you are on a commute. And so I've got to get you at the beginning or the end of the commute if you don't put the ReliefFactor.com in your car. And remind you, take it today. Take it every day. You will feel better than you do than if you did not take it. That's the guarantee, is that Icarian, Curcumin, Resveratrol, and Omega work together as nature's anti-inflammatories to ease the minor aches and pains that come with getting old or getting on the airport and putting luggage in the overhead bin, the thing I least like to do when traveling. Nevertheless, got to be done. You got to do it if you're traveling today. You got a long commute, whatever you're doing. Remember, ReliefFactor.com will work for you. Finally, I want to tell you about a new sponsor, UnAmericanExpress.com. UnAmericanExpress.com. Go there, because UnAmericanExpress.com is an answer to the wokeism that has deeply impacted American Express. Their 2021 Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Report is about as woke a document as you can read. So UnAmericanExpress.com, which does not believe in race consciousness in any aspect of American life. They believe in the Martin Luther King content of our character test. Not the color of our skin, the content of our character. Not woke values, but patriotic values. Head over to UnAmericanExpress.com right now. Find out more about what American Express is up to and why you want no part of it. UnAmericanExpress.com. I'm coming right back, America. Stay tuned.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Color Us United.
This is Hugh Hewitt for townhall.com. Buckle up for 2022. The year in politics is going to be rough. The midterm election year seems predestined to banish the Democratic majorities in both houses of Congress. The country senses infirmity in President Biden, and many worry that our adversaries in China, Russia, and Iran sense that opening too. The shadow campaign for the GOP nomination in 2024 opens now, with a clear frontrunner being former President Donald Trump. The ranks of the top tier among possible GOP presidential nominees in alphabetical order starts with two senators, Arkansas's Tom Cotton and Ted Cruz of Texas. Then we have the populist Florida Governor Ron DeSantis, the former Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, and South Carolina Senator Tim Scott. If the world grows even darker in the days to come, Cotton and Pompeo, two former soldiers, start with some advantages. It's possible one or more will run whether or not the former president does. My bet, with 3 years to go, is that Trump runs and runs hard. Buckle up. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
Publicpolicy.pepperdine.edu. Trending now on the Larry Elder Show.
The Supreme Court has said is you have to have a compelling state interest, and the compelling state interest that the Supreme Court found was the benefits that flow from having a diverse student body, whatever those benefits may be. But you have to have a diverse student body to get these certain benefits, okay? So that justifies this kind of racial alchemy in terms of admissions. Here's the problem. Increasingly at schools, you have, regardless of how supposedly integrated they are, you're getting more and more racial separatism. Separate classes, separate dormitories, separate graduations. There's more and more of that going on. And one of the basic reasons for that is because of mismatch, because of the serious mismatch in academic qualifications between Asians, Latinos, blacks, and whites.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
You want to know what's even crazier and funnier in a sick way? There's a security guard right there. The shoplifter, the looter, walks right by the security guard who isn't doing anything. He's got a jacket on with the big security on the back of his coat, and he stands there and watches the guy. The guy literally brushes right by the security guard. The security guard, what are they paying the security guard for? Just to stand there? Why don't we just put mannequins up in stores in New York? I may never go back. I swear, I may never go back. New York is turning into a hellhole. And Democrats are watching it. They're letting it happen. I can't wait to get Joe Borelli's take on all of this insanity.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
You called your son and you personally promised him you would be here.
Lucas, I don't know how to help you.
Your daddy loves you, you gotta know it, pal. Do you
feel the love? Prayer is a powerful thing, Ethan. It really does work, if you believe.
What reason does he have to care about some guy who's supposed to be his dad, but he's never around?
I can't do it, I can't. I'm not ready for this, man.
I'm done with you.
Hell. We all deserve a second chance, right, Ethan?
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
This is Carol Platt-Lebow for townhall.com. Sometimes there are policies so destructive that at first you don't believe they're true. Joe Biden is currently defending one, his plan to award $450,000 to migrants separated from their families after entering the U.S. illegally. Children of deceased U.S. soldiers are separated from their parents permanently. They don't receive this kind of money. And migrants who enter the U.S. legally certainly don't get this kind of payout. The really big jackpot, it seems, is being reserved for the lawbreakers. There are some obvious truths here. First, behavior that's subsidized gets repeated. Joe Biden is effectively inviting many more illegal immigrants to breach America's open borders. Second, he's betting over time the payoffs will benefit his party in political terms. Meanwhile, the vast majority of Americans watch in shock and dismay as our president, the country's chief law enforcement officer, brazenly rewards lawbreaking, a clear violation of his oath to defend our nation's laws. It's a sorry sight indeed.
Trending.
Schools are lining up to push the transgender agenda on kids and cut parents out of the equation.
Go to salemnow.com.
Hey, Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. There are books, and then there are timely books, and there are eerily timely books. I hold in my hand General H.R. McMaster's Battlegrounds, The Fight to Defend the Free World. He joins me now. Good morning, General. You up at Stanford this morning?
Hey, good morning, Hugh. I am. Good to see you.
Well, thank you for joining me. We began setting this up 6 weeks ago, so people should understand before Putin invaded Ukraine, and we're thinking about Russian new generation warfare from 2014. Is the playbook the same, General McMaster, as I think you describe it here in Battleground? It looks awfully like 2014 all over again.
Yeah, it does, Hugh. I'll tell you. I mean, this is Putin's playbook. Is I think of it as the four Ds, right? Disrupt. Whether it's with cyber attacks or the threat of a conventional attack like we've seen and the coercion of Ukraine with really an effective blockade even on the southern coast as he's massing forces around Ukraine. And then disinformation is the second D of the four Ds with, you know, cyber-enabled information warfare against us to diminish our will. What he wants is disunity between the U.S. and Europe, disunity within our own societies. And then what he wants to achieve is denial, the third D. He uses implausible deniability, this kind of crazy speech given Monday night in which he's trying to pose, you know, trying to pose this idea that Europe and the U.S. and are the aggressors, right? The Ukrainians are the aggressors. This suggestion of, you know, genocide in Donetsk and Luhansk is ridiculous. It's implausible deniability, really, what it is. And then the fourth D is dependence, right? He wants Europe dependent on him so he can coerce Europe and he can make sure that any response to his aggression is tepid. And this is especially, you know, with oil and gas. You know, Germany in particular gets 50% of its natural gas from Russia and 41% of its oil. And Germany can't keep the lights on now because of a ridiculous energy policy. So it's the four Ds in action. But, you know, I think we're doing okay so far, Hugh, in terms of the response. There's a lot more we could do, I think. But I think it's clear from this speech and this kind of theater, right, with his cabinet on Monday night that Putin's determined to continue this offensive action. And I think he's on the cusp of starting a major war in Europe.
Now General, let's pause for a moment on the adequacy of our response. I've had Senator Cotton on this morning, Congressman Gallagher on the Senate and House Intelligence Committee, respectively. They believe it's too little too late and that especially the oligarchs have to be expelled from the West. Do you agree with that? That there are, as the Navalny 25 Gallagher tells me, I think there are 300 oligarchs running around Great Britain. What do you think we ought to do with these people who might have influence in Russia reaching up to the tyrant?
I think it's a good idea to sanction them because these are people who really stripped the Russian economy in the 90s and especially after Putin came to power. These people are often called Putin's wallet, right? These are the people that he goes to maintain power. It's really, Hugh, I think it's kind of a protection racket with these people. Putin has dirt on everybody, so he keeps them from killing each other. He keeps the corrupt system going, and he stays in power. You know, some people think, you know, Putin might be the richest guy in the world. You know, the estimates are that it's at least, you know, $221 billion in his pocket. But, you know, the money he's got is based mainly on handshakes. So it depends on him staying in power. So what you see is a Vladimir Putin who's desperate to stay in power, desperate to keep his ill-gotten gains. And I think by sanctioning those around him, you might start raising doubts among them. Hey, is it worth having this guy around? He's already been around for 21 years. He extended his rule till 2035. Should we let him do that and destroy the country? You know, real wages in Russia have been going down for the last 8 years, Hugh. Right? When do people get tired of that? Now, he's got a lot of reserves built up. He's got probably $640 billion in reserves because of the ATM machine of his oil and gas exports. But I'll tell you, it's not looking good for the Russian economy. And I think it's clear now that we need a concerted response to encourage Russians to make a choice. This guy is good for them. He's dangerous for the whole world.
If the Great Brits and America list the 250 top Russians who are about to be expelled and said, we've gone three, now we're going to do another three every day until you stop, doesn't that generate some more specific pressure than the generalized SWIFT banking and banking? Those are dissipated as they move down the food chain and up towards Putin. But if you go after the oligarchs, those are sharp blades at people close to him.
Yeah, they are, and you know we have already put many of these sanctions in place. But with these sanctions, they have to be maintained, right? Because if you sanction individuals and their companies, you know they spin off a little shell company and they adapt to it over time. So I think the renewed effort on this is good, and I think also the multinational effort. And you know I think if the Biden administration has done anything well, I think it is to get as much as they can out of our European friends and partners so that there's a unified response. Hey, one of the things Putin wants more than anything is disunity. And there's been a fair bit of that, you know, with President Macron going there, maybe making some promises and, you know, on the part of the Ukrainians, which he has no power to do. Germany's response was tepid, especially because of their dependence on Russian oil. But overall, it's been pretty good in terms of the unified results. So I think that we're in good shape in terms of the unity of effort. And I think we're going to continue to see, you know, an emphasis on making sure we can all work together.
Now, General, in Battleground, you trace the 2014 invasion that Putin orchestrated through his little green men to the decision by President Obama to do nothing after the red line was crossed. How much do you consider Putin's actions this week to be connected to our collapse in Afghanistan last year?
Absolutely connected. Absolutely connected, Hugh. And you're right. In Battlegrounds, I draw this line. I really see it clearly, you know, between the unenforced red line in Syria, 2013, 2014, after Assad commits mass murder of hundreds of people, including hundreds of children, and the inviting of Russia into Syria, right, to enable the serial episodes of mass homicide, which are the Syrian civil war. That allowed Putin to not only extend his influence in the Middle East, not only to enable Iran there as well, but also to create a migrant crisis, which he's using to weaken European resolve. So what he does is he creates this migrant crisis. Then what he does is he supports a lot of the nativist parties and tries to polarize European societies like he does with us too, pit communities against each other and weaken their resolve. You know, Putin plays a great game. He plays a strong man, but he doesn't have a lot of resources. Hugh, his economy is the size of Italy's economy. And so what his theory of victory is, he can drag everybody else down and he'll be the last man standing. I think he saw weakness, obviously, in our surrender to a terrorist organization. I don't know what else you call it in Afghanistan and retreat there. And what he's doing is he's acting on that perception of weakness with renewed aggression, renewed offensive against Ukraine. I think Xi Jinping is also emboldened because of this. And we're likely to see, I think, you know, Xi Jinping become even more aggressive in the South China Sea and against Taiwan as well.
Now, General, will you speak to the problem we have in the American media? Whenever you say something like he's played his hand well or what President Trump did very inartfully yesterday, the media in America is more interested in attacking Republicans and trying to make it look like a recognition of Putin's evil genius is an applause of Putin's evil genius. Now, Fiona Hill wrote, Mr. Putin, you quote her on page 29, Putin thinks, plans, and acts strategically. And that's not any different. We're not praising him. But why is the American media fixated on the fact that the recognition of his malign abilities is not, it's not the same as saying, way to go, Putin. It's not even close. He's a miserable, horrible character, but the American media jumps on this stuff.
Yeah, I don't know why. You know, this is something we ought to all come together behind, right? I mean, this is
yes.
You know, this is clear. We have to remember 14,000 people already died in Ukraine, and the people in the eastern part have suffered tremendously. You know, Ukraine is actually being punished a lot more than Russia's being punished right now because of the effect on trade and investment. And this is what I would like to see more of, Hugh, is more support, right? As we recognize. The effectiveness of Russia's aggression, we also should recognize, hey, when he meets stiff resistance, he stops, right, and pulls back. I think an example of this is in Syria in February of 2018. A lot of people forget
yes.
this. Russian mercenaries, I tell the story in Battlegrounds, you know, they attacked our special forces and the Syrian Democratic Forces in Syria. Why? They did it because they were sitting on the Conoco oil facility. And you know what Russia needs? Russia needs that oil to help reconstruct the country they helped to destroy in Syria. And so they attacked with this Wagner group. We killed over 200 Russians. What did the Russians do? They didn't say anything. They did everything they could to hide the casualties. So I think while Putin is posturing, you know, I think that the fact that the Ukrainians are much better at defending themselves now and the support that we've given them hopefully will be enough to deter a continued offensive against the Ukrainians. But I'll tell you, as I look at it, I look at what they're doing. You know, we've seen the reports of, you know, field hospitals and blood banks and everything. I think he's getting ready to renew the offensive and to, you know, to go even more deeply into Ukraine.
General, shock and awe may be coming. The Prime Minister of Australia warned last night within the next 24 hours. Shock and awe did not reduce Saddam's militants to hiding. They just regrouped and came back. Will shock and awe, in your opinion, work against the Ukrainian defense forces and shatter their ability to resist and lead to the quick capitulation of the country?
You know, it could lead to tactical gains. So what we're talking about really is what we in the military, joint operations, right? This is air, land, sea operations aimed to strike, you know, targets in depth and then to follow rapidly with the ground offensive operations. That's what we want to achieve, is speed of action. And what you will try to gain here is more than physical destruction. What you want in war is you want a psychological advantage, right, that allows you to achieve a lopsided outcome in battle. But, you know, Hugh, war is, we have to still remember this, war's politics, right? It's like the Geico commercial. Everybody remembers, everybody says that, right? Everybody knows that, right? That's what Clausewitz said. But what that means is that you have to be able to consolidate gains to get to a sustainable political outcome. And the Ukrainians, I'll tell you, are not willing to accept, you know, a puppet government. They're not willing to give up their sovereignty. And I'll tell you, you know, Putin has done more to strengthen Ukrainian nationalism than anybody ever has in the past. And Ukrainians, as you can see from the reporting there, are really rallying behind Zelensky. You know, this narrative of, you know, that the Putin's going after Russian speakers. Hey, Zelensky's a Russian speaker. You know, the president's a Russian speaker. So I think Ukrainians are rallying. They're doing the best they can. They deserve our support. I think, I'll tell you, Hugh, I think our military support in terms of accelerating defensive capabilities to the Ukrainians was pretty weak in the beginning. It actually took the Brits, you know, to do it first. But now we're doing it, and others are as well, the Baltic states. And, you know, I think this is a little bit like 1973, you know, when Israel was under duress, you know, from the Arab coalition, and we flew in a tremendous amount of support that helped the Israelis defend themselves, you know, successfully.
Yeah, Nixon said, send everything that can fly. And I hope we're doing the same thing. Before the break, I do want to ask you if you see, you detail that the Internet Research Agency, which is Russia's bot farm, it's Internet warrior arm, they had at least 109 Twitter accounts masquerading as news organizations. Do you see the same thing right now, General McMaster? Are they up to the same level of malevolence online?
Yes, they are. It's really peaked. You can see the efforts at disinformation and propaganda. Really, they're maxing it out, right? So they're on social media, right? They're on TikTok now. You know, one example, Hugh, that I saw just a couple of days ago, were these rockets impacting in high-rise apartments, right, in the eastern provinces of Ukraine, the ones that are illegally occupied, you know, by Russian proxies. Hey, well, that was Russian attacks in 2014, but they're recycling it, trying to show it like it's now, to reinforce this false Putin narrative of, you know, of genocide, you know, in the eastern provinces. So I think we're going to see more and more of this.
I'm coming right back with General McMaster. His book, Battlegrounds, could not be more timely. We're going to talk about China, Iran, North Korea, and more. But as to the Russian new generation warfare, you've got to read Battlegrounds. Stay tuned. This is Hugh Hewitt for townhall.com. Buckle up for 2022. The year in politics is going to be rough. The midterm election year seems predestined to banish the Democratic majorities in both houses of Congress. The country senses infirmity in President Biden, and many worry that our adversaries in China, Russia, and Iran sense that opening too. The shadow campaign for the GOP nomination in 2024 opens now, with a clear frontrunner being former President Donald Trump. The ranks of the top tier among possible GOP presidential nominees in alphabetical order starts with two senators, Arkansas' Tom Cotton and Ted Cruz of Texas. Then we have the populist Florida Governor Ron DeSantis, the former Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, and South Carolina Senator Tim Scott. If the world grows even darker in the days to come, Cotton and Pompeo, two former soldiers, start with some advantages. It's possible one or more will run whether or not the former president does. My bet with 3 years to go is that Trump runs and runs hard. Buckle up. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
publicpolicy.pepperdine.edu Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
Thanks. All right, thanks.
You want to know what's even crazier and funnier in a sick way? There's a security guard right there. The shoplifter, the looter, walks right by the security guard who isn't doing anything. He's got a jacket on with the big security on the back of his coat, and he stands there and watches the guy. The guy literally brushes right by the security guard. The security guard, what are they paying the security guard for? Just to stand there? Why don't we just put mannequins up in stores in New York? I may never go back. I swear, I may never go back. New York is turning into a hellhole. And Democrats are watching it. They're letting it happen. I can't wait to get Joe Borelli's take on all of this insanity.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
You called your son. You personally promised him you would be here.
Lucas, I don't know how to help you.
Your daddy loves you. You gotta know it, pal.
Do you feel the love?
Prayer is a powerful thing, Ethan. It really does work, if you believe.
What reason does he have to care about some guy who's supposed to be his dad, but he's never around?
I can't do it. I can't. I'm not ready for this, man.
I'm done with you.
We all deserve a second chance, right, Ethan?
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt, joined by Lieutenant General HR McMaster. His new book, Battlegrounds, The Fight to Defend the Free World, could not be more timely. I also read, to prepare for this dereliction of duty, General McMaster's first and epic history of the Vietnam conflict under Presidents Johnson and Defense Secretary McNamara. I'll come to that after the break, but I want to go, General, if I could. I want to jump over China. I'm going to come back to China. In Battlegrounds, you do Russia, China, and then you get to Iran. But I want to jump to Iran right now because it looks like, and Senator Cotton is afraid, that we are going to find ourselves with a new JCPOA in the middle of Putin's invasion of Russia in an attempt by the Biden administration to keep down the price of oil. What would you make of the strategic implications of a new JCPOA as described in the press right now?
Hugh, Tom Cotton's right about this. You know, what we're doing right now is we are supplicating to the Iranians. And you mentioned, you know, the perception of weakness associated with the surrender and withdrawal from Afghanistan. That's magnified by what we're doing with the Iranians. So the Iranians have been stepping up their proxy war in Iraq. They try to kill the prime minister of Iraq, you know, with drones. You know, they're intensifying their proxy war in Syria to assist Assad in, again, these serial episodes of mass homicide. But what they're really trying to do, Hugh, is put a proxy army on the border of Israel. And ultimately, they aim to destroy Israel. They say it. We have to listen to them. Houthi rebels in Yemen are firing rockets at the United Arab Emirates and into Saudi Arabia. And while they're doing that, we're over in this negotiation situation with them where we don't even get the privilege of talking to them directly. We have the Europeans supplicating for us to the Iranians, and they're demanding more and more concessions. We're giving more and more concessions. The deputy negotiator, Hugh, just resigned. He couldn't stomach it anymore. And this is a Biden administration appointee. And what we're going to get is another weak agreement. And what's significant about it, what you're asking about is the strategic implications, is it's going to allow them to continue their missile and their nuclear programs because the verification regime will be too weak to ensure that they're not, just to give them cover for that. I mean, do you really believe the supreme leader of Iran? Do you really believe the Islamic Revolutionary Guards Corps? And then the other part problem is the sanctions relief, Hugh, is going to give them an influx of resources that they're going to use to intensify their proxy war further and to extend the you know, this theocratic dictatorship's grip on power. Because the beneficial owners of the companies that are going to get these profits from relaxed sanctions are the bunyads, which are these conglomerates that really are the kids oftentimes of the most senior officials. So, you know, it's going to be a disaster. It's a political disaster. It's going to be a political disaster masquerading as a diplomatic triumph, just like the first JCPOA was.
Well, that will be exposed, I think, quickly. But the overriding concept of battlegrounds is strategic narcissism. And I believe negotiating with the Iranians right now is peak strategic narcissism. And we've got Wendy, what else do you want from the United States? Sherman over there negotiating, as she did in 94 with North Korea, as she did with the first JCPOA, as she's doing now with Iran. Strategic narcissism is the projection, if I'm correct, General, correct me, obviously you used the term, the projection onto our enemies of our values and means and ends. And they're just not the same.
They're not the same. And the point that I make in Battlegrounds is, hey, we have to pay more attention to the ideology, the aspirations, and the emotions that drive and constrain the other. Because if we don't, as you're mentioning, right, strategic narcissism is what makes us vulnerable to a whole range of cognitive traps. You're talking about mirror imaging, but also optimism bias, right? And
yes.
Confirmation bias. I mean, hey, the Iranian regime is still driven by the ideology of the revolution. And what they are determined to do is to fight against the great Satan, us, the little Satan, which they call the UK, but they call Israel the cancerous boil who they want to wipe off the face of the earth. Now, should a regime like that have the most destructive weapons on earth? No, but the JCPOA is not going to prevent them from getting it. It's not. And so I think, Hugh, what we're going to see, if I make a prediction here, is that this will be, if there is an agreement, it'll be an extremely weak agreement. As a result,
now General, I'm tethering the ideology of a regime from the regime is a strategic mistake. I just want to know if Iran has a Shiite end times ideology. China is Leninist. North Korea is the extreme cult of devotion to the leader. Does Russia have an ideology, or is it just Putin?
Yeah, I would say it's a nationalist ideology that is grounded in the sense of honor lost at the end of the Soviet Union, and then the failures of the reforms in the 1990s. Now, what Russian leaders want to do is they want to blame us for that. They want to blame us for, you know, for the criminals who stripped out their economy as they transitioned to this really, you know, kleptocracy out of the communist system, and so the ideology is a sense of being dishonored and victimized by an avaricious kind of West, right? And Putin has stoked that as best as he can. And what he's trying to do, it's not to the extent that you see in China with the Great Firewall, but he wants to dominate all platforms of communication and information. You've seen how your fellow journalists have been persecuted and murdered in Russia, and how the state television has become the platform for this disinformation. It's really interesting, you know, in the provinces that surround Ukraine.
Hold that thought, General. We're going to come back after the break and continue. Don't go anywhere, America. We're going to get to China after the break.